Sydney, New South Wales, Australia. Population 4.5 million. It is Australia's most populous city, and it's also the nation's most vibrant and much loved destination. Three hours west of Sydney is Mount Panorama, Bathurst. 6.2 kilometres of tarmac that is respected globally by the best drivers in the world. It's a place where the brave prosper and the weak fall behind. Get it wrong and it will punish you.
Oh no! There's carnage at the top of the mountain here!
Get it right and it will reward you. Today, the world descends upon this great mountain for Australia's international endurance race, the Liquamolly Bathurst 12 Hour. Amongst the 54-car field are some of the biggest marks in the motoring world. Ferrari, Lamborghini, Porsche, Aston Martin, Bentley, Mercedes-Benz, McLaren, Audi, Nissan. All brands with a remarkable racing pedigree. 169 drivers from 15 countries will tackle this mountain, and the level of talent is immense. Amongst them are Formula One stars, Le Mans 24-hour champions, and Bathurst heroes. There are the veteran champions and the young stars of the future, but all have one common goal. Today, that is a Bathurst victory. This is a race where there are no second chances. These drivers will be living and breathing every waking moment at this world-class piece of motor racing real estate. This is Mount Panorama. This is the Liquamolly Bathurst 12 Hour.
Yes, a very good morning, everyone. Welcome to Mount Panorama, Bathurst, Australia, and welcome to the Liquamolly 2015 Bathurst 12-hour race. There is a lot of excitement here on the mountain. Of course, it is only the early hours. There's still quite a chill in the air, but this pit lane is a hive of activity as crews get set for what is going to be a fantastic 12-hour race. 169 drivers are here. They represent 15 countries. This is a truly international event and a great test of endurance. We know this circuit. We know the challenges it presents. We know how difficult it is, and that's what we're looking forward to seeing today. Already we've seen some incredible developments this weekend. The fastest officially recorded lap in the history of Mount Panorama, and we've seen five different manufacturers occupy the top five spots on the grid. We've got an Audi on pole position, we've got a Lamborghini on second, and this, the Nissan GTR, is third on the grid. Now, it was involved in an incident yesterday afternoon. It went into the cutting, suffered severe damage. It was taken into a workshop in Bathurst at 6:30 last night. At 11:30, it returned to the track here. The crew have been working until just an hour or so ago, until 4:30 this morning, to get the car right. The good news is it is good to go and it will be on the grid. So let's find out the who's who of this year's Liquamolly Bathurst 12-hour race.
I think the Australian audience would know me best for driving Porsches around the world, and came to Bathurst last year for the first time.
People know me normally from racing in Europe. I won the total 24 hours of Spa. I won the Blancpain Endurance Series in 2013.
Biggest race ever. The one, it's 12 hours of Sebring, Le Mans 24 hours, and Spa 24 hours. So for sure, for me being here in Bathurst as a 12-hour race, it's a race I would like to win for sure.
I don't think people know me from racing because I'm not really as a lot of history as a race car driver. But I have broken the speed of sound in 2012 with a project called Rebel Shadows. Right after my Trump Audi driving experience called me, asking me if I'm interested in competing at the 24-hour race of Nürburgring in Germany. And I said yes, and did a lot of preparation, and then finally I was ready to do a race at the 24-hour of Nürburgring.
For any driver, whenever someone says, would you like to come and do Bathurst, the grin on your face is massive.
I knew Bathurst as an iconic racetrack. The speed, the ambiance, everything, it lived up to the hype and then some.
Bathurst have opened up, you know, this 12-hour race, and each year it's just getting more and more stature overseas. So if you look at the field, it's a very, very strong field of GT3 cars.
There is risk there, but at the same time, we want to, at least on the top five, fighting for the podium and if it's possible for the win.
Both cars are maybe in the top five or top three at the end.
We want to race for the win, obviously, but be there for the last couple hours where we can just go flat out and try to compete for at least a podium.
So we are now within minutes of the rollout from pit lane and getting the cars gridded up. The teams you can see are out on the grid here. There's a great sense of excitement about what lies ahead. Probably the most spectacular Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour race we've seen. So let's head upstairs and join your commentators.
Thanks, Mark. Beautiful scenes here this morning. It's John Hindorf, Richard Krill and Graham Goodman, the editor of dailysportscar.com, to take you through the next 12 and a half hours. Well, the first thing we need to do, because we made history on the mountain yesterday, a place that has plenty of history associated with us, is look back at qualifying, which Krillsy was quite extraordinary.
It was a remarkable day, split over two sessions, 1 hour and then 20 minutes. This is the Craft Bamboo Aston Martin that had an off. This was a big crash for Ivo Brookers in one of the Mark Cars Australia entries, the Mazda V8 powered car. There were dramas for Vicious Rumour Racing, but the Audi was looking early in qualifying as the car to beat.
Yeah, the Phoenix car looking really good. Ferraris have always gone round here, and John Bow says it's a Ferrari circuit.
Christopher Meese in the Hallmark Property Group Audi topped the first stage of qualifying, Graham Goodman, and he was looking strong, the young German.
He looked like he was going to be unbeatable. Didn't he even end up in the top eight when we saw the second session, though, Krillsy?
This man was impressive. David Russell, the Queenslander, was on top for a lot of the shootout part of qualifying yesterday. 20 minutes with just the Class A cars. This was the defining moment, though, of qualifying yesterday.
Gio San in the Nissan GTR going for a second quick lap. He'd already set a fantastic lap time and he backed it in at the cutting. That's the third time we've seen somebody do that this weekend.
The New Zealand team, Trust Family Racing Ferrari, pulled off to the side of the road midway through the session. They'll start just outside the top 10. But this was the performance. The 23-year-old Belgian driver, a champion in GT racing, Laurens Vanthoor, took the Phoenix Racing Audi R8 to the Alan Simonson pole position trophy with the fastest ever lap recorded here, 2 minutes 2.5 seconds. And Bruce Morrison from Liqui Moly presenting the young Belgian driver with the trophy. The cars are rolling out onto the circuit and Shay Adam is down in pit lane with more.
Cars are rolling out. The car that just rolled out from behind me was the B class pole sitter. The time set by Ben Barker was good enough to make it halfway up the Class A category. That is one car to watch today. Luke Yolden will be starting. He is filling in for Earl Bamber, who drove the car last year, along with Ben Barker and Stephen Grove. They won the category in 2014. Luke Yolden won his class in 2014 as well. This is a car to keep an eye on for today.
Absolutely brilliant down in the pit lane. While the cars are on the mountain, we'll take a short break from you so we can get ready to go racing for the 2015 Liqui Moly 12 Hours of Bathurst.
Full darkness.
Well, it's not often you see a motor racing grid being put together in full darkness, but that's what we have here at the Liqui Moly Bathurst at 12 hours. And Krillsy, you've been to a lot of these. We can see the crowds of cars, the lines of cars coming in. This is looking like a cracker.
It's going to be unbelievable. Let's go down to the very front of the famous Mount Panorama starting grid where we find Mark Beretta.
Guys, it is quite extraordinary down here to have 50-odd cars lining up on the grid in the darkness at Mount Panorama is something quite unique. The event is the hard work and the brainchild of James O'Brien, event director. James, congratulations. This event is just growing. We can see everywhere we look, it's 5:30 in the morning and there are crowds everywhere.
Yeah, I'm glad there's other people up with us. But no, we're delighted with the growth of the event. Over 50 cars, 20 different nationalities represented, and there's been a lot of people involved to get to this stage, a lot of stakeholders. If I can name a few, the New South Wales government have been great in supporting this event. Bathurst Regional Council, the stewardship of this iconic circuit, and of course all our sponsors, and not to mention the volunteers, there's 500 here this weekend. But of particular note, our naming rights sponsor, they came on board a few years ago, they saw the potential of the event, and they've been an active partner in the event, and we're delighted to have Liqui Moly on board with us.
Yeah, they are fantastic, and Bruce Morrison is here from Liqui Moly. Bruce, you must be very proud when you look around and see this. It's a great partnership you've got.
Oh, Brett, we're over the moon, mate. It's our third year. I look at the field, I look at the crowd. Super excited. We never really thought it would get this far, this fast, but it's great to back a winner.
And this is an exciting year and some good news for you guys going forward too.
Yeah, look, we're proud to announce an extension of our contract with James for another 3 years. I'm sure it'll be a lot more years after that, of course, but another 3 will be great. And look, I'm on it upward now.
Excellent. And James, that's good news. It really cements the event for the next few years.
That's right. And as I said, they're an active partner, Bruce and his team at Liqui Moly. The big boss is here from Germany, so I hope he's watching. And we'll get him out here and have a good day today.
James, all the very best. Have a great day, Bruce. Thanks once again. Shay is down in pit lane.
Wolfgang Riep, you are starting your first time Bathurst. It's your second trip to the mountain, but you didn't get a lot of laps last year. You get to start the car this year. How are you feeling?
Yeah, I feel quite excited. I think we've shown so far that the car was really good here. So, yeah, I can't wait to take the start. I think 5 minutes to go. And I hope everything goes well. And we will see where we are after 2 hours.
The mechanics had a bit of work to do on your car last night. Did it feel back to normal on your one lap around the mountain this morning, mine being at very slow speed?
Yeah, they worked very hard all the night to repair the car, and now of what I've done so far, all feels great.
Thanks and good luck, Wolfie. Back to John in the booth.
Thanks, Shay. We're going to count down to the race start. We'll get a break out of the way before we go racing so we can show you as much as the start as possible. The start of the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour is coming your way right after this. Evidence of the popularity of motor racing at the mountain and international motor racing with a cast of stars from all around the GT and endurance racing world. The traffic jam on the way into Mount Panorama and on the front straight, as well as 54 of the world's best crazy, get ready to go racing.
Good morning. We will show you the race start in not too long a time. This is the grid thanks to Michelin. The young Belgian driver, Laurens Vanthoor, will start this race from pole position after an amazing job, but it will be Marco Mappelli who starts the 15 car. Alongside him, Roger Largo, the owner driver in the number 32 JBS Racing Lamborghini, will start from the front row of the grid, though. It looks like Steve Owen will be in that car. Wolfie Riep in the Nissan starts car number 35 from third place. They've been very strong so far this weekend. The AF Corsa Ferrari is fourth. Car 77, Stephen White behind the wheel. Then Darryl O'Young in the Aston Martin. Five different brands in the top five. Mok Wensung, the Asian GT champion, starts the Clearwater Racing Ferrari from the next row of the grid. Then it's Jack LeBrock in the Erebus Motorsport Mercedes-Benz SLS AMG. Car number 36, Richard Muscat behind the wheel of that one. Clark Quinn in the McLaren, the Australian GT champion of 2 years ago, starts the 12C. Then Christopher Meese in the Audi. Graham Smith in, Guy Smith, that is, in the Bentley in car number 10. And Stephen Richards, a Triple Bathurst 1000 winner, goes from just outside the top 10 in the Lamborghini.
The clock's running, guys.
Clock's running. The cars are rolling behind the AMG CLS 63. So effectively, we are now racing. So for those of you who aren't used to this, perhaps coming to us for the first time, and there are many of you, then what we're seeing now is effectively a safety car start, if you will. But what that will happen, halfway around the warm-up lap, the green flag lap, the lights will go out, the safety car will clear off, and then effectively the pole sitter has control of the field. Now, there's no passing before the start finish line and no overlapping either on green flag restarts. That's something that people got pinged for last year. Jeez, it's dark out there. There's going to be all, it's going to be like the front row of a scrum. Who knows what's going on? Unbelievable as they come off the top of the rise down towards Griffin Bend. There's all kinds of dirty deeds could be done out there, Krilzy.
It will be Marcus Winkelhock who starts the pole position car, the Phoenix Racing Audi. So a driver with experience at the very highest level miraculously led his one and only Formula One Grand Prix start for the Spyker team at the Nürburgring quite some time ago.
Quite a wee while ago. All 50 cars on the grid have got away safely, and look how dark it is at the top of the mountain there. This is going to be spectacular stuff when these guys get to full racing speed.
Sunrise just after 6:30 local time, so there's going to be probably half an hour of proper dark running. It will be a challenge in these opening stages of the motor race, but the cars behind the Mercedes-Benz safety car, they'll grid up two by two when they get down to Maguire's Murray's corner and go racing proper.
The advantage is, of course, when people say that, well, you know, 12-hour race, why you want to qualify at the front? Because you get to see down the road. Everybody behind is looking at your tail lights, and then all you've got behind you is an explosion of light from these very, very efficient headlights that cars have nowadays. All you can see is there is something behind you. You won't know what it is. You'll be looking left and right. The sensible guys will just be looking straight down the road, and that is the key for the first half an hour, 20 minutes. Let's get to the first pit stops. That's what all the team managers will have told their drivers, and that's going to be just over the hour or thereabouts for most of these cars. One or two changes in the fuel tank loads, particularly for the Mercedes-Benz. They've got 10, 12 extra litres. That'll probably take them another 6 or 7 minutes into the race, and I think they'll go over an hour this year, which we haven't seen before.
Coming through Skyline and over to the left, the guys can see the lights of Bathurst down way, way, way below the kind of the height they are there above the city of Bathurst is just quite astonishing when you see it in real life. But here they come now, down the mountain, ready for the start of the latest endurance racing classic.
Yeah, that is a word that we will use an awful lot this weekend. Let's head down and get some of the atmosphere from pit lane. Here's Mark Barretta.
Hey, guys, absolutely incredible down here. Everywhere you look around this circuit, there are crowds lined up in the early hours. Say good morning, everyone. We're wound up and ready to go. Have a look at them up there, and that's right along pit lane. Everyone up here getting set for this fantastic race start. Let's get it going.
Thanks, Barretts. So how do you win the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour? Well, to do so, you'll be making at least 12 pit stops, we think, per car, basically one per hour. That means you'll be putting more than 1,000 litres of fuel through your racing car. Each car has 12 sets of either Michelin or Pirelli tyres to utilise over the distance. If you want to break records today, you'll need to do more than 296 laps. That's more than 1,840 kilometres. They are the lap and distance records. You'll be racing at an average speed of 155 kilometres an hour over 12 hours, bearing in mind that the pole lap yesterday was done at 153. And there will be safety cars. The average is 6 per race, but we've seen as many as 15 over the course of the distance in the past.
And how people deal with the tactics of that are going to be part of how to win the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 hours for 2015, which is ready to go green. The huge crowd on the front straight and around the mountain are going to get their money's worth today, and so will you as you stay with us. It is the pole sitter, the 15 of Marcus Winkelhock, who brings them around. Beautiful 2x2 start, waiting for the green flag, and the first of the big classics is underway in 2015. Watch for the guys diving down the inside into Hell Corner. It looks like a clean start all the way back, 3-4 breast as they went into the tight left-hander at the start of this race. And it is just a huge amount of light as they head up the mountain straight for the first time. Bit of dust there. There was somebody went wide. I have no idea who it was in the darkness.
Good luck picking who's who, but Steve Owen got away pretty well in the JBS Racing Lamborghini, side by side to Griffin's Bend at the top. It's an Audi leading though, so it will be Winklevoss in the 15 car. The pole sitter got a good start. Owen was away smartly, went round the outside, but that's a Nissan GDR in second place with Wolfgang Rieck behind the wheel. Good start for the Nissan. Darryl O'Young in the mix. The Aston Martin looks like it's got net gain as well.
Good to see the second place, John, but I think he was looking there for the lead into turn three. Didn't quite make it. It's the Audi that leads up onto the mountain.
I love people flashing lights in the early part of the race. We're halfway around lap one. Let's flash me lights because I'm sure he's going to pull over and wave me by. Not going to happen. At the head of the field, the Audi has the yellowish tinge on the headlights. At least we can see that. And Wolfie Rape has been scored in the lead as they've gone over the top. Now, let's see if we can get visual confirmation of that. Our Nissan leading on the mountain. That would be a brilliant start for the young man who came through the GT Academy. We might just have lost the transponder on one of the cars because everybody's moving up. Let's check it out. No, there's the Audi. You can see the headlights as they go through the Falcon Elbow for the first time.
Yeah, Audi leads. It looks like Nissan second and Lamborghini third with Steve Owen, veteran around this place, doing the job for the JBS team that have been so fast and already 10 car lengths for Marcus Winklehock leading down Conrod Straight for the first racing time at speed. These GT3 cars will do 285 kilometres an hour. They'll be flat through the kink at the chase. They'll break at about 120 metres before the top of the hill at the Michelin Chase. Get the car turned in and complete the first lap at speed for the 2015 Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour. Winklehock your leader, Reap in second. Steve Owen sits in third. Darryl O'Young is fourth. Steve Wyatt fifth for AF Corsa Ferrari as they cross the line for the first time at speed.
And the crowd on the front straight are making some noise here. We can almost hear them above the sound of the engines. And it is Winklehock, Wright, Owen, Darryl O'Young, then Steve Wyatt, Musket, Meese, Clark Quinn in the mix as well in 8th position, Steve Richards, and Guy Smith in the first of the Bentleys in 10th position. Stefano Telli, another Le Mans winner, two together there. 1998 and 2003 Le Mans winners in 10th and 11th position. That is the quality of the field here on the mountain.
So gains for Darryl O'Young, two-time winner of this motor race, driving for his own team this time around, Craft Bamboo Racing out of Asia. The Aston Martin Vantage V12 going well, fourth place behind Steve Owen. Also, another two-time winner has made ground on the opening lap. Christopher Meese, the young German, has got himself up a few places. He's now seventh in the Hallmark Property Group Audi.
Six different cars in the top six. Watch them, listen to them. It's all very different. They're going to be quicker in different parts of this circuit. You're going to see positional changes before too much, very much longer as the guys get down to the rhythm, John.
Maxi Burke was the guy who was making up all the positions early on. I think that was he who was flashing the headlights in the 11. He's now up, he's made half a dozen places. He's up to 16th position, Krills, and that's impressive in the traffic.
Richard Musket gets Steve White in the Ferrari, so the Erebus Motorsport SLS AMG moves to P5 with the reigning Australian GT champion behind the wheel. The young Victorian star in the making in the GT world moves to fifth place. Erebus going for youth over their usual international talent they bring to Bathurst for the 12-hour every year. But so far, at least this weekend, it has paid off spectacularly because Richard Musket, Jack LeBrock and Dean Canto have done a great job in the 36 car. And the youngsters Simon Hodge, Nathan Morecambe and 16-year-old American Austin Sindrick have done a super job in the 63 entry. They're a little bit further down the field, but they will progress over the course of the day.
Is it harder in the wet or in the pitch black? That's the question that's been asked on Twitter at the moment. And if you're going to tweet to us, the hashtag on the top of the screen, hashtag B12HR, B12Hour. And keep that social interaction going at the moment. I can't keep up with it. It's dropping down the screen so much. But there's clearly a huge audience for real motor racing on a real circuit with real cars doing what they do best, racing in the darkness.
But we've got a virtual racer, as was, now a professional racer, now back right with the leader, because Wolfgang Rieck in the Nissan GTR pulled right back onto the rear boot lid of the Audi, now nose to tail.
Is there any more scary sight then, looking in your mirror, than Godzilla just gently towing back towards you in the darkness?
It's like a 200 mile an hour version of Pac-Man up there. It is.
It's like a John Carpenter film, isn't it? That you can feel the tension rocking up with the lights of Bathurst in the background as they're going over the top now for their third time.
And predictably, the Audi, as it has been all weekend long, mega across the top of the mountain. These cars, if you're unfamiliar to GT racing, produce their speed in different ways. The Nissan has proven so far this weekend to be very good up and down the mountain in the straight bits across the top. The Audi seems to be unbeatable. And yesterday, Lawrence Vanthoor's pole lap, he lost 0.3 seconds in the first split to the cutting. He made up almost a full second from the cutting to Falcon Elbow
stuff. Across it was the top an of the astonishing hill. Lap. And again, as you look at the, it's exactly the same as they've gone across the mountain this time. 0.8 seconds pulled out from Marcus Vingegaard and Wolfgang Riem after Riem got a couple of tenths closer. But it's the run down the mountain now where you're going to see the Nissan close up again. There they go, almost a V-Max. And the Nissan closing back up on Marcus Vingegaard's Phoenix Audi. It's a fantastic thing to see these things on the mountain.
And to hear them as well, Graham. You've got a V8 mid-engined car, a V10 mid-engined car leading, and then that twin turbocharged front engine V6, as of course Nissan GTRs have to be, going across the line now. You've got the screaming Ferraris, you've got the rumbling Astons and the burble of the Bentley as they come around. And we've got glowing brake discs and glowing exhausts, the things that photographers and we as spectators love to see.
Marcus Vingegaard, lap 3, 2:06.40. Wolfgang Riem in the Nissan behind, 2:06.47. An 8-1 for Steve Owen, an 8-6 for Richard Muscat, 8-8 for Daryl O'Young. But it's amazing when you're in the traffic in these early stages, in the dark and the glowing dawn at Mount Panorama, how the lap times drop off when you get back into traffic. A lot of guys taking it very, very easy. The leaders, who have got clean racetrack around them, going very, very hard and setting good lap times.
And being compared by the viewing public to Le Mans back in the classic days when there were fewer lights on, Jordan Taylor, a GM Chevy Corvette driver and one of the leading lights in the IMSA series in the States, just tweeting through to say, man, this looks like Le Mans back in the day. Jordan, you should be here, my man, and so should Corvette.
Some talk about a Holden influence in this race in the future. We've seen them partake in endurance racing here. They ran a sports wagon in the production car base 12-hour back in 2010, and of course the famous Monaros back in the 2000s in the 24-hour version of this motor race. They might be back, and there's a couple of different GM branded GT3 cars on the way, a Corvette, a Camaro, and indeed a Cadillac as well. So Jordan, make sure you come to Australia next year.
Yeah, Doug Feehan needs to have his arm pulled up his back. It would take him 2 seconds to come down here, the program manager from Corvette. Whilst we're watching the front of the field, let's remind you there are other classes. This is a mixed category race, and shortly, and that's the sign that I was wondering how long we'd see before we got into some traffic. So we'll keep you up to date with those different classes as we come down. Let's head back down to the pit lane and the relative clear and light of Mark Barretta.
I'm with the man who grabbed pole in a sensational lap yesterday, the fastest lap we've ever seen on the mountain here officially. Lawrence Vanthoor, congratulations on yesterday. That was an amazing lap.
Yeah, thank you very much. It's a pretty great honour to have pole position in a race like this. A lap record at Mount Panorama, which is quite an exciting track. So it's a real honour. I'm really happy about it. Even if it's only a small part from a 12-hour race, it's quite nice for myself and the team.
Now, not the first time you've been here. You were here last year for the race. How are you finding the circuit this year?
Well, this year we obviously are a bit in a better position than last year. But I love the circuit. It's especially qualifying, it's just 100% excitement, and you have to push to the limit, and you know if you make one mistake, you destroy the car and your weekend is already over. So it's a really big excitement.
Now Marcus is in the car at the moment, he's holding onto that front spot. How's the early feel?
Everything feels well. We will do our own rhythm for the first half of the race. We will not look too much to the others. We have our own plans in mind, and let's try to do that and then see where we end up.
Lawrence, do you know when you'll be jumping in?
I will be in the car around 10.
Right, good luck. Have a great day. All the best.
Thanks.
Strategy here is going to be how you manage the tyres early on in the cooler conditions and later on when it's hotter. Got some inside news from Michelin yesterday evening. Their runners starting on the soft, definitely able to double stint, possibly triple stint the cars in these early morning hours.
Replay down the inside. That's one of the Bentleys with contact. And Maxi Book.
No, it's not. That's David Brabham.
The Flying B racing entry. That's the Australian customer entry going up the inside of the second of the Phoenix Racing Audis, the Crocodile livery number 16 car. So Brabs getting into it early.
Hey, talked about sorry, Graham, talked about the different classes early on. This is the TTRS running in the categories further back down the field. It's not just for the big bangers up front, and you can see just how long it's taking for the heat to dissipate from the front discs on that car. It's almost like he's riding the brake. He won't be, but that's how hard the brakes are working, and what looks like a very straight stock car heading up the hill. Big, big glowing of the front brakes there underneath the wheel ribs. 2.5 litre, five cylinder, proper Audi Quattro, old fashioned rally car sound on this car.
And it's great to still see the production car component of this race remain quite strong this year. That Class D, the Invitational production class, is still very, very strong, and looking forward to a class battle. That was Stefano Ortelli in the Audi, by the way, that copped a hit from Brabs down at turn one. So a man with plenty of experience.
But former teammates.
Won't be very happy about that. We're seeing, I suggest to you, Krelsey, the fastest laps we've ever seen in the dark around the mountain.
I would think we can call that a record, yes.
205.66 from Wolfgang Riep in pursuit of the leader.
Going across the Seven New Skyline area of the circuit. It's taken half a lap for the discs on that TTRS to cool down, and now he's going to just warm them up again as he heads down towards the Falcon Elbow. These cars are going to get worked very, very hard in the next 11 hours and 43 minutes.
So the margin at the front, 1.3 seconds at the moment, and that's remained consistent. And Winkelhock and Reek just trading sector times at the moment. The Audi so good across the top of the mountain. Wolfie Reek so good up and down it in that Nissan GTR Nismo GT3. Steve Owen, 6.3rd. He's 11 seconds now behind the lead in the JBS Racing Lamborghini. But, oh, we've got a spin up. That's one of the invitational entries.
This is a former Grand Am Cupra Mazda. This is the 41 car that's nosed in at the cutting.
Mark King behind the wheel, very experienced driver, races the Touring Car Masters Series in a classic Chevy Camaro.
And a word for our corner workers and marshals, by the way, over 500 of them around the circuit. There's a little bit of smoke coming out the back of the Mazda. Don't worry about that. They burn a lot of fuel on the rotaries when they're trying to start them up and run them at a low revs. These screaming cars, Mazda's still the only Japanese manufacturer, of course, to have won Le Mans in 1991. He's got reverse. He's been guided back by the marshals. He's put himself in harm's way there, though. And he'll need to get all the way to the wall and wait and wait and wait. And the Kraft Bamboo, Aston Martin coming through there. Well, that was a little bit on the dodgy side, and he's not got any lights on in the front either in that former Speed Source car. And he's going to be a moving chicane. Do you remember, did you have TCR when you were a good kid? That's like the blocker car going up the mountain.
He needs to get out of the way, doesn't he, Mark King? And this is just another look on the Maguire's replay. Very, very close at the cutting. It's such a narrow entry to that corner, and it looks like one turn, but there's a kink before it.
Absolutely.
That's completely and utterly blind and unsighted. So Mark's had an issue there, not sure if he was helped or did it on his own. He's a hugely experienced racing car driver and has had success here in endurance racing as well. Those Mazdas are a great addition to the race as well. Barrett's in pit lane.
Well, with Dave Russell, who did a superb job yesterday putting the Lamborghini into second spot on the grid. And Dave, I know you would have slept with a big smile on your face last night. That was a great achievement yesterday. Well done.
Yeah, look, it was. I'm really, really proud of the Largo Racing and JBS team. Hey, we're only a small team. If you have a look at all the factory teams up and down, you know, we're just based out of a small workshop out of Brisbane. Roger Largo, the team owners, put a good team together. And, yeah, I'm very proud of what we've achieved so far, you know, today's race day. And, look, Steve's off to a really good start. You know, he's in P3, but he's got a really good gap to the other class cars behind us, and that sort of allows him not to be worried about another car in his mirrors and just focus on, you know, we're up to lap traffic already, and he can just, you know, keep focusing on his stint without worrying about a guy that's all over in his mirrors.
Dave, we'll leave you, have a great day. We've got another incident on the track, boys.
Yeah, and this one will bring out the first safety car and a full course caution. This is one of the GWS Class D Invitational production cars. It's the BMW that's off to driver's right. That looks down like it's down on the driver's right at Conrad Street there, Krilzy.
Yeah, Anthony Gilbertson behind the wheel of the BMW M3 GTR.
One of the favourites, by the way.
Yeah, a car that raced here in the 24-hour in the early 2000s. It's been upgraded since then. They've got semi-factory assistance from BMW's race tuning arm in the United States. Steve Dynan builds the engines for that car. Good program this weekend, but unfortunately it's ended very early for them.
Now the bonnet, the hood is up on that car, and I'm wondering whether that was cause or effect. He's got the four-way flashes on as well, and there's clearly been a bit of contact with the wall at some stage. But I wonder if that bonnet wasn't secured properly and that's caused an issue for him. Safety car is out, the Mercedes-Benz CLS AMG, and in early pit caller, the number 48 Lamborghini. Now this is rolling the dice on strategy. Let me tell you about safety car rules here. The pits do not close except for when the safety car is on the front straight. So if you can get a sneaky pit stop in and back around onto the tail of the queue, you're doing a great job. So the Hallmark Holmes car brings out the first safety car period of the Liqui Moly Bathurst 2015 race.
No massive urgency down there, so the safety workers just talking to Anthony behind the wheel. This team, they're a real true privateer battler outfit from Queensland, and they've spent the last 12 months just preparing to be here and to race this car at Mount Panorama. They don't race it anywhere else except this event. So it's an early out for the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour. While we are under the Mercedes-Benz safety car, we'll take the opportunity to get a breakaway. Back with more from the 12-hour on the other side of this.
So the sight we expected but hoped we wouldn't see, that of the very beautiful Mercedes-Benz safety car, the AMG 63 CLS, for the first time today with the 42 BMW in the wall on Conrod Straight. Let's go down into the pit lane and see how the strategy's playing out. Shea Adam.
John Bowe was one of the winners of this race last year. You come back a champion again. But you're in a different car, a very different car, the Bentley as opposed to the Ferrari. How have you been adapting to the Bentley so far this weekend?
Well, I mean, the Bentley's quite new to us as a team, so we're all learning as we go along. It's very different. I mean, the end result is not overly different as in lap time, but the way they drive, the way the messages you get through your backside and your hands and things is quite different. So even though their performance is not greatly different, the brain messages are very different.
Well, David Brabham is in the car right now, started the race. What has he been reporting to you about the handling and the way the car has been performing?
Well, he's had a bit of a tough time so far. He was touched from behind, I think, by one of the other Bentleys. I'm not sure, but I believe that's what it was. And then he had a touch with another car in turn one. So hopefully we get all that rubbish out of the way and we can, you know, keep pressing on for the race. It's a huge, long race, and these guys you see in the background here, they had a key to it all. They do all the numbers and do the strategies, and, you know, they keep it all on track. So they're good guys too. They're smart, and, you know, all we have to do is drive and stay out of trouble. So that's the easy bit.
Easier said than done, as we just saw with the BMW, unfortunately. What is it that you heard about the car?
Well, I heard that he hit a kangaroo, which is, you know, happens almost every year. And the Bathurst City Council, they've gone to untold lengths to put up anti-kangaroo fences, but some of those kangaroos can leap, you know, over tall buildings almost. So that's obviously what happened. It's unfortunate. I hope we don't get any more of it because it's very dangerous.
Well, speaking of leaping over tall buildings, let's see who Mark Beretta has.
Hey, Shay, I'm here with Stephen Richards, a man who knows how to win at the mountain. He's done it four times before. Steve, early feel out there. What was it like starting this race in that car?
It was good. It took a while to wipe the sleep out of my eyes from the early start, but it was okay. It's a little bit difficult. Some of the inside walls are painted black, so it just takes a little bit of time to get your confidence to find where the apex is. Don't want to go too close. It could be a bit of a disaster.
Did you do that by feel?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah, fortunately not.
The Lamborghini, has it settled in today? How are you feeling about the car?
Yeah, the car's really good. We've been, you know, focusing all week on making the car better and better as a race car on heavy fuel. So it feels absolutely fantastic. So with these conditions, the times will come down. It'll be super fast.
Big endurance event today. How do you manage it? How do you keep yourself physically and mentally ready to go?
I think, you know, it's just important to keep yourself fresh all the time. When I say that, you know, sometimes you don't want to feel like having a sandwich or a banana or whatever, but you just got to make sure that you're fueled for your brain, for the concentration, because that's the biggest thing around here is, you know, one slip up of concentration can be pretty costly.
Now, you know this place and this magnificent race, but isn't it great to see so many people out, such a big crowd here today enjoying it early in the morning?
Yeah, it was excellent. We had to queue up to get in this morning at something like 4:40 or something in the morning. So great to see. I mean, the campground's been full all week. All the spectators that have come down and are interested to see these awesome looking cars, it's fantastic. So I think we're shedding a whole new light on Australian motorsport for our motorsport fans.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Steve, all the best today. We'll keep in touch. Thanks, mate.
Thanks, Brett.
Thanks, Brett. With Triple Bathurst winner Stephen Richards. And would love to add a Liquid Molly Bathurst 12-hour to his credit. Reports coming through, and this is from the Only at Bathurst file, that car 48 has indeed hit a kangaroo on Conrod Strait. And you can see down on left of screen that
just
car
under
hit
the Nissan,
yeah, under the Nissan bridge, so out of the Falcon Tyres elbow, and it slid down Conrod Strait, probably 700 or 800 metres just before the first hump in the straight. So that's a shame to end that race.
42, not 48.
42,
It's the BMW. Good morning to everybody on the spectator banks here. We can actually finally see you now with day beginning to break. We enter another phase of this fantastic race.
And the people. So go back, 7 or 8 laps to the start. Pretty clean. I'm never sure whether being on the inside here is an advantage for the Pullman, because you can get rather swamped round the outside. No overtaking, of course, before the start line, and I actually thought that Pullman did a pretty decent job, Winklehock, of defending his line.
Yeah, he did. Steve Owen made a very good start in the 32 car, but was on the outside, and Winklehock barreled into turn one, hell corner. It's called that for a reason, and I think if you were about 31st in that pack, that's what you would have been thinking right about then. So that was the running
seeing. I'm off into hell.
Just confirming, I was a bit confused with car numbers. The 48 car was the car that Stephen Richards jumped out of there, put Justin McMillan into that car.
And half pitted, and the only one, I think, of the top category of cars that have come in. Oh, hang on a second. No, I'm just seeing Stefano Telling's been in the pits.
And the 99
well.
Aston Martin has just been in and out.
Okay. So there's one or two people rolling the dice then and getting out of kilter. Coming in on Twitter using the hashtag B12HR, Nick Holland, back over in the UK, where it's 7:20 in the evening there, 8:20 in Europe for all our international viewers, pointing out that getting out of shape in terms of the pit stop schedule is not a bad thing when you have such a busy pit lane, and he's absolutely right there. Take the opportunity. If it falls in the window and it works for you, sometimes you can do it. If you try and push it too much and try and make something happen, often you can fall foul of that. Sun coming up very quickly. The light levels from our fantastically efficient cameras as the field go around the Falcon elbow aren't quite as good as that to the naked eye, at least not to this old pair of naked eyes.
And off the quick opinion, I think Stefano Telli's early stop will almost certainly be because he could, and because the team would have wanted to have a quick look to see whether or not there was any damage from that clash. As we see the evidence now of the damage to the 42 being flat-bedded back to the pit lane.
Guy Smith up to 8th position, by the way. Remember, we were talking about battling for 10th and 11th with Stefano Telli, and Ollie Gavin, another GM factory driver, but this weekend in an Audi, is up into 9th position in the number 5 Audi. Now, you can't come in if you're the leader now. You've got to stay out. You're not going to give up your track position, so the decision's made for those at the front of the field, and Wolfie Reap has got a couple of B-class Porsches him and the leader.
I think if they would have pitted, they would have done so already, like we saw with the 48 car. So it looks like at this stage they're staying to their course. Now we expect 25 to 28 laps to be the fuel window today. This race is not going to be a race decided on tyres, at least not in the early stages. All the teams reporting remarkable tyre life. In fact, on Friday, the Grove Racing Porsche, which for much of the weekend has been the class leader in Class B, did more than 350 kilometres on one set of tyres. So, remarkable endurance. So, tyres won't decide pit stop strategy today. Fuel will. And you'll need to stop 25 to 27 laps, a little bit longer if you can stretch it out. The safety car will help that cause. So, for every lap of safety car you do, you'll get probably a quarter of a lap in the bank to keep up your sleeve, to extend that stop. And they'll all be cruising around in a high gear just to keep the revs down and don't burn so much fuel. So they'll be keeping that in the back of their minds for the stint. They might go as long as 30 laps this time round.
Well, the bad news, of course, is we've had this early safety car. The good news for anybody sitting trackside and watching the TV is the leaders are going to have a clear track in front of them again. We're going to see some very fast laps as soon as the safety car pulls in here. I'm absolutely sure of that because the guys have got much better vision now, of course, with the sun coming up. And almost into full daylight now here at Mount Panorama. It's going to be almost like the starting guns fired again.
And we'll see some fast times now as well. Now the light's up, the ambience up, people will have much better vision. They'll have a little bit more confidence in the air and track temperature. 14 degree air temperature, 18 degree on track. They're creeping up slowly and will go up very quickly as the sun rises. Forecasted top today, just over 30 degrees. So it's going to be a lovely day in New South Wales, beautiful central west. But we'll see some very fast lap times. And of course, these cars will be producing a lot of horsepower in this cool, crisp mountain air.
And watch out for any overlapping of the cars ahead as we come back to the green flag over the 7U Skyline. You can see where it's called Skyline and Mount Panorama when you look to drivers left and see right out across the Macquarie River Valley. And such a beautiful part of the world here in New South Wales, not just for the motor racing. There's water sports up at the dam, not so very far away, and some fantastic trails. And this is a destination that you really can come to any time of the year, and you get the advantage of having one of the best strips of tarmac anywhere in the world, which you can drive, of course. It's a public road, 60 kilometres an hour, and two-way traffic makes life quite interesting. And of course, the Australian Motorsport Museum is here, which Graham and I took a chance to wander around very quickly yesterday. Thanks to the staff there for making us so welcome, which is any petrol head's dream. So plenty of reasons to come to this part of New South Wales, whether you're in Oz or further afield. So no overlapping on the restart. That means you can't get alongside and try to intimidate the guys. You can only make those kind of moves after the start finish line, and we have seen people pinged for drive-through penalties for that in the past. Graham Goodwin, what do we reckon early on then? This is going to throw a little bit of a spanner in the works to some of the bigger teams. Oh, I'll ask you that later because the safety car lights are out. Now he'll accelerate away from the field, which is now under the control of Marcus Winkelhock. He's going to stop weaving left and right because that's another thing you're not really supposed to do as you come back to green. He's just cleaning his tyres. You don't get any heat in the tyres by doing that. You just scrape the top of the surface. Now, just one car between first and second, and he's not in the fight. So that white Porsche in between the Audi is going to be a great blocker, and Marcus Winkelhock senses that, gets his foot down as he comes out of the Michelin chase, down towards Maguire's Murray's corner, and onto the front. Oh, a little bit of understeer for the leader, the car pushing wide. You can almost hear the tyres squealing as he comes through. A magnificent restart for the Phoenix Audi, and Wolfie still has to get past the Porsche, which he does do. Remember, he couldn't make any move early on board with the masterful driving techniques of Wolfie Reed into third, fourth, just a little bit of oversteer coming out of Hell Corner as he goes up Mountain Straight now for the 12th time.
Yeah, Winkelhock got a free kick there with that Porsche in the way, and of course, Wolfie Reed couldn't get past until he got to the control line on the start-finish straight. To give you an idea of the temperature here at the moment, Winkelhock at race speed swerving to warm up his Michelin tyres on that Audi on the run-up Mountain Straight to turn two at the top of the hill. So just trying to get tyre temperature up after that lengthy safety car period. Five laps under yellow already, 36 and a half minutes into the motor race. Winkelhock leads for Audi, Reed for Nissan second, Steve Owen for Lamborghini, the privateer team from Brisbane in third, Richard Musket up to fourth, and Christopher Meese gets past Darrell O'Young. So the number nine Audi, one of the fastest cars of the weekend so far, with the young German, a double winner at this place behind the wheel, is now inside the top five. Darrell O'Young in the Aston Martin back to sixth, Clark Quinn from McLaren seventh, Matt Halliday in an Audi in eighth, John McIntyre in the Trask Ferrari up to ninth inside the top 10. And rounding out that 10 is Maxi Book in the number 11 Bentley.
And what that restart has done, gentlemen, is closed up the battle for now second and third. Wolfie Reed, remember, couldn't get on the loud pedal early enough to get by that Porsche. So he's now got Steve Owen and Richard Muscat right up his tailpipes as they come
appropriately enough, under the Nissan banner on the first part of the Conrod Straight. And Steve Horn looking very, very racy at the moment, right in the gap, right in the hole in the air that's been made by the Nissan, down through to the Michelin Chase and Rich's Hotel just on driver's right here. And I dare say there'll be a few people enjoying breakfast on their balconies while watching Great Motor Racing. What a fantastic venue to be at this morning as they come through to complete lap number 12.
It's a big gap now from Marcus Vinkelhock back to Wolfgang Rink. Remember, tenths of a second just for the last lap before the safety car came out. That gap now up to 6 seconds, and you're absolutely right, John. We've now got a, what, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5-car battle for second position, courtesy of Marcus Vinkelhock having got away and Wolfie Reap having struggled to get the heat back into the tyres on the restart.
And that battle is Nissan, Lamborghini, Mercedes-Benz and Audi for the four.
Winkelhock on his first flying lap, and we see the Motorsport comparerinsurance.com.au car with Pete Storey behind the wheel. Aston Martin, British team, off the road on the exit of Michelin Chase. Winkelhock bangs in a 5-5, fastest lap of the race on his first full green flag lap after the Mercedes safety car. And he has got his head down, eyes forward, and he's driving very, very quickly. And the gap 6.1 seconds, and already to the first split, he's added another 2 tenths. So clear track for the number 15 Audi. And Marcus Winkelhock putting in a very, very good performance. This is probably the strongest car across the board in all three drivers. The young Italian Marco Mappelli, who's the Italian GT champion, came out of Aussie F3 in Australia, actually, so he's familiar to these parts. And, of course, Lauren Fantul, who overnight, anytime you set anything that can be construed a record or the fastest ever time of this place, you're instantly into the folklore of the place, and that's what Lawrence did last night.
And we said we thought we'd see quicker laps as the cars went back to green. Of the top 20, 19 of the top 20 set their fastest first sector of the race so far, and it's looking like the same in the second sector too. But the two sectors so far on this lap for the number 15 car, Marcus Vinkelhock, are both purple. This is a very quick lap indeed from Marcus Vinkelhock. 2:05.57 last time around. You see the Trask Family Motorsport car, Carl was in trouble in qualifying yesterday. Here comes Vinkelhock, a 2:03.66 for Marcus Vinkelhock. The Trask Family car, though, the 27 car, back wow. in the mix.
Up in the ninth position.
3:06 at, where are we? 6:30 in the morning at Mount Panorama. That is an amazing lap. 2:03.6, the gap 7.1. A couple of people I'd like to point out for doing a very, very good job so far, especially one of them is the number 63 Erebus SLS AMG. They've charged from 19th and up to 13th now with Nathan Walker behind the wheel.
Two friends having a battle out on the track. Ollie Gavin in the Bentley and right in his wheel tracks. We've got Ollie Gavin and Guy Smith together. Guy Smith in the Bentley, Ollie Gavin in the... In the Audi, the Squirk Audi, thank you. If my brain's going blank at this time of the morning, we're in real trouble in 10 hours' time.
We're used to seeing him in a GM product.
That's
strange to see him without a Chevy bow tie on the front.
I keep wanting to see it in the Corvette, of course. Ollie Gavin has driven for more than a decade in the United States and around the world. And it's the two Bentleys then holding on to positions inside the top 10 as they are being chased down by Ollie Gavin.
That lap from Winkelhock is a lap record for this race. 2:03.85, set last year by Van Gisbergen. And that is a lap record on lap 13. It'll go. It's going to go this lap.
It's gonna go again.
He's going purple all over the timing board already. So this has been a fantastic first stint for Winkelhock and really did benefit from that safety car. And the lapped car between himself and the Nissan GT-R have really helped him. We look at Pete Storey up the inside. That was a hold your breath moment.
That was into Griffin's bed, and that looked like that might have not ended well. Look how comfortable you are in a Bentley. Sixth gear down towards the Michelin Chase. Conrod, can we see the speed on there? Has he got the speed up on the dashboard? Look at the dashboard. This is a GT3 car, by the way, turning in at 180 miles an hour. And look at how much equipment he's got on there. Of course, obviously, some of that will be for the air conditioning, the massaging seats, and the drinks cabinet being a Bentley.
3:05.8 for Winkelhock, the leader. Another new race lap record. 3:09 for Wolfie Reap. So Took a little bit longer for the Nissan to get its tyres up, but now it's quick and it's all but matching the race leader, Steve Owen, only doing 205s at this stage. Wonder if they're running to a plan in the 32 car.
Little wheel dropped off by Maxi Berg there, and Guy Smith, very relaxed, very, very economic with his movement behind the wheel of the Bentley. It's a big car, but it drives small, is what the drivers tell me. It's easy to position. Sixth gear going up, mountain straight, coming into Griffin's Bend, down, one, two, three gears, turn in, hold it, now release the lock, get the power on, ride the curb a little bit, but not too much because that wall, it is a nasty angle, fourth into the cutting, hold on to fourth, now down into third, now down into second, turn in, keep turning in, use the camber of the road to straighten you out. Out through the other side, already up through the hill. Change up quickly so that you get the car balanced. In the middle of shot there, that is John Wickham, the man who has been with Bentley for such a long time. Now over the top of the mountain, and Guy just dancing on the pedals as well as trying to hold on to his teammate. Just a little glance in the mirror there because Ollie Gavin is sitting behind him as they go across the 7U skyline, and just closing up now on his teammate as they go through the S's and through the dipper down towards the Falcon elbow. Now this is going to be very interesting. He might have to just move his teammate out of the way. He'll certainly get a bit of draft as he comes out of Falcon elbow. No oversteer there, please, because that's a nasty moment. You're sliding towards the wall, very easy to clip the right rear. Up into sixth gear again, nice and early, letting the 4-litre V8 Bentley ahead of him, the Bentley motor ahead of him, just pulling down, and Ollie Gavin is right in the wheel tracks of these two Bentleys from Crewe.
So car 11 leading car 10, Maximilian Buch, the young German who became a hero here 12 months ago when he raced, challenged Craig Lowndes for victory. The Maranello Motorsport Ferrari held on and got the victory. Of course, they are not in this race. They were out after first practice on Friday. A big crash at the top of Mount Panorama, a collision with the number 99 car. Tony D'Alberto was behind the wheel. The car was all but destroyed. Unfortunately, a replacement was unable to be found, and that team withdrew from the race late last night. And we say very good morning to Tony D'Alberto, who will be watching from home. He's back home with his young family and watching on. He's very stiff and sore, but A-OK.
There was a car here. There was a deal to be done, but the deal could not be reached, and that will be frustrating, particularly for Tony. An AF Corsa car here, which was owned, is owned by Amato Ferrari and still owned by Amato Ferrari. Wasn't able to get that one done in the last couple of days. So the battle continues just on the bottom end of the top 10 with Maxi Berg in 10th and Guy Smith and Ollie Gavin. And here's how they look, Grilsey.
On the Michelin hourly update leaderboard, Winklehock your leader. So Audi, Nissan, Lamborghini, Mercedes, the top four. Four different brands in the top four. Christopher Meese in fifth place, the young German. Darrell Young is sixth. Clark Quinn is seventh. John McIntyre is eighth. Matt Halliday up to ninth, driving very well and making ground in the Evolve Technic Audi. And Maxi Buch in the Bentley, we were just looking at rounding out the top 10. All in the Darrell Lee outright class. In the professional and amateur divisions, Winklehock leads the professional class. Reap in second leads the amateur division with just one or no seated drivers in the Nissan GTR. Luke Gilden leads the Century Batteries Class B, the Ridges GT4 class, led by the Aston Martin St. Gallen entry, and it's great to see them back at Mount Panorama. The Daytona Coupe leads Class D in the GWS personal car. The Mark Focus leads Class I, thanks to Recaro. A break from the mountain and more after this.
And it's all happening early with the brilliant golden hues of dawn already bathing Mount Panorama. Marcus Winklehock just there involved in clipping a Porsche who he's put off to the side of the road, and we'll pick up on that one in a moment. We've also got an Aston Martin that's facing the wrong direction, and that's further back down the mountain at the cutting, but no full course caution yet, so clearly being dealt with local yellows. But Marcus Winklehock and the 15 Phoenix Audi is leading the motor race.
So passing car six, the safety stop Porsche at the top of the mountain was down the inside. The safety stop car got out into the marbles and made contact reasonably heftily with the wall just before McPhillamy Park. So Hopefully Richard Gartner's okay and continuing on. No sign of the Mercedes-Benz safety car yet, but the 34-year-old German is doing a great job out in front. The margin, 13.8 seconds that, over the Nissan.
That courtesy, Krelzy, of a very slow middle sector from the Nissan, I suggest, because we've had those cars into the wall.
I lifting think he up had there lift,
with a yellow
yeah.
flag. I'm not sure, John, that he did make contact with that Porsche. I think Krelzy's absolutely
close.
Right. He pulled wide, got onto the kind of slippery stuff and clanged the wall very heavily. I'd be very surprised if we don't see that car pit.
Well, there's a bit of damage on the right-hand side of the Audi. I think there has been a bit of contact side to side there. If you're not on the right, behind the where the blade area is on the car, it's just flapping a little bit, and that wasn't doing that earlier on. I think there's just been a tiny little kiss there between the two cars. And into the pit lane comes the safety stop Porsche right underneath us.
Into the garage.
Let's have a look at this again, guys. It's traffic. He's looking. He comes up the inside. The Porsche's unsighted. No, there's no touch. I take it back. But he's on the grey.
Oh,
that's very, very unlucky for the Porsche. And Marcus, I take it back.
Yeah, so Richard Gartner, known amongst the paddock as the Minister for Enthusiasm, because he is always the most up and happy person. I'd suggest he might not be at this point in time, because that was quite a hefty contact. They may spend some time in pit lane, but he did the right thing. He tried to get offline, but it really is a single-line racetrack up there at the top of Mount Panorama. He just got a little bit wide, and it forced him into the fence. Well, they've got that car turned around very quickly. I think Shay Adam has more on that in pit lane.
Yeah, guys, the six came into the garage. They wheeled it in, drove straight in, looked at the damage, and decided it was not bad enough that they needed to spend time fixing the car. They're moving it back out onto the pit lane as we speak. They're going to refuel it and then try and send it back out onto the track to assess further if there is more damage. But Aaron Zarafos, you're one of the drivers of this number six Porsche. What did your driver report happen?
Yeah, it looks as though coming up the top at Reed Park, there was a faster car behind, and Richard moved over to the right-hand side and clipped the wall. But I don't know the extent of the damage, but it's early days, so we should be okay.
Can't be that bad if they're, oh, no, refueling. Now they're bringing the car back into the garage. They'll work on this, and then hopefully you'll get out into the car.
Yeah, that's right. Hopefully we can fix it, and I'll jump in and probably do a double stint. So we'll see how we go. Thank you.
Thanks, Aaron.
That is a classic piece of Porsche liftoff oversteer, and really, really bad luck there, because I have to say they did nothing wrong. Marcus was being very forceful, sticking his nose in there. There was a gap, but this is all part of the game here. Neither of those drivers really at fault there. Marcus wanted to make time. And
has, John.
Well, yeah.
And has, still in the 204s. Everybody behind 208s, 209s. The gap now up to 17 and a half seconds, and he's done that gap through traffic. That gap was, what, 7-8 seconds? He's more than doubled it with a little bit of aid and abettance from a yellow flag at the top of the mountain. But Marcus Vengelhock has done a masterclass in traffic around Mumford Panorama.
He's had quite the career, hasn't he? Of course, from the famous Vengelhock family, Manfred and Jochen Winkelhock over the years. Famous names in both Formula One and Le Mans sports car racing throughout the years. But this guy's raced at the very highest level, and as we said, he's the only driver ever to lead his first and only Formula One start in a wild and crazy Nürburgring Grand Prix in 2007. It was when he drove for the Spyker Formula One team, which has morphed and merged its way through various incarnations. It's now Force India. After that, some time in the DTM, the German Touring Car Masters Series, and the GT1 World Championship after that, which he won in 2012. So he's a driver with huge credentials. He's showing them this morning.
It's Cavallari in the Mazda V8, sister car to this car, actually. Underneath, they're identical, the Mark Cars Australia V8s, but you can chop and change the body styles, which is a great concept. Big fan favourites here last year when three of the Focus ran. But this year, we've got the V8 in the front of a Mazda 3 style of car. And that, is this the future for endurance racing, or perhaps even other forms of racing? I'm not sure. It's a great concept. And every time I've seen them run, and they've been across to Zandvoort and Dubai as well for the Hankook 24 Hours earlier this season, they've shown really well. They've been quick and reliable. And who doesn't like a V8 engine? Let's be honest.
Especially at this place.
goes well.
Leader pushing very, very hard at the head of the field and everyone else trying to chase them down. And still Guy Smith has got Ollie Gavin in his wing mirrors and rear view. And Ollie just sitting, playing the waiting game. I know that Ollie was desperate to get back here and was like a kid on Christmas Day when he found out the deal that was being done and he'd be back in an Audi looking for class and indeed overall honours. Don't count these guys out. The 35 Nissan going nicely in second place with Wolfie Reef. Hello to Al Buncombe and to his partner Gemma. A new addition to the Nismo Global Athletes team is young Austin William, who was born yesterday, and that's why Al isn't here. He was hanging on just a little bit, holding up proceedings just a little bit, and arrived late, but all doing well, and our best to the newest member of the family.
Now, for your information, over the course of the day, we'll run through on our ticker at the top of the screen the running order through each of the classes. We'll give you gaps, intermediate splits, and everything that goes on throughout the race. So keep an eye on the ticker. Right now we're running through the Darrell Lee GT3 Outright class. Five classes in the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour field.
And top of the mountain at the moment, coming down the mountain, in fact, here comes Wolfgang Reed, but he's suddenly found a bit more pace. Clear of traffic now, and we're starting to see the lap times come back for the Nissan GTR. Wolfie, they're putting in the quickest sector of the race up the mountain. It's what we saw in the very early laps of the race, and quick across the mountain too, and looking to just claw back to that 17 and a half second gap now that he's got between him in the second place.
Oh, contact! Just got up the inside of the Mazda. Maybe a little bit ambitious there, I think, from Wolfie Reap, and it's cost him time as well. Does a 4-3, but he was on for the fastest lap of the race. He dived down the inside, a little bit of hesitation from the mark focus on the Maguires. Reap, like, turned in, and Reap went down the inside. He could have waited and passed him in a straight line on the Liqui Moly front stretch. In my opinion, I think he should have just backed out of that.
Mixed messages, though, from the car being overtaken. I agree that Wolfie had time to take it the next time, but it looks like the door's open to you. You start to make that move, you're on the ragged edge of adhesion in terms of getting down the inside, and you're already braking as late as you can. Then the issue is, he's got to get stopped. He did a really good job of not hitting that car and damaging him or indeed the car he was trying to pass.
Takes two to tango.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Case, yeah, so both needed to be a little bit heads up. Fortunately, there was no contact made and everyone lives to fight another day. And they'll live to fight another 11 hours and 1 minute. This is the car that we saw with a drive-through penalty early on. Now, a safety car infringement, we believe, for a pit lane restart, so we'll confirm that for you. Been another Porsche, I think car four actually going okay. Yeah, Luke Gilden leading class four. Car number four is currently scored just outside the top 30. Shay Adam with more from pit lane.
Kevin Estra, we've been seeing a lot of entertaining driving so far out on the track, but Clark Quinn's been going well. You're up into seventh position overall. McLaren's working better apparently.
Yeah, it's good. We've got some problem during the week in the free practice, but we sorted out for qualifying, so quali lap time was pretty okay, and now Clark is doing a really great job keeping up the pace and on seventh place, so it's looking good at the moment, but the race is really long, and we really got to get out of trouble because there have been some already, so yeah, it's looking good.
What has Clark been reporting about the track conditions?
He said it was pretty cold at the beginning, so hard to get the tires up to temperature, but then seems to be okay. And after the safety cars, he got some really good laps, so he's feeling all right.
Now, it's your first time to Bathurst, to the mountain. You've been to Nürburgring. You set the fastest lap time at Nürburgring. Is it similar?
Yeah, it's like a small Nürburgring. That's how it feels on the track, because you've got a lot of blind corners, uphill, downhill, a lot of fast corners, so it feels really great, and I love this track, so this is definitely one of my favorites.
And when will we be seeing you get behind the wheel?
Sorry?
When will we be seeing you get behind the wheel?
I think I will be second, but I think Clark is going to do a double stint, so maybe in about an hour.
We'll look for some fast lap times from Kevin Estra in about an hour then.
Shadam in the pit lane, fast and furious on the mountain. We wouldn't have it any other way. What a brilliant way to spend your Sunday. And we'll have more of it. There's plenty of racing still to come from the 2015 Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 Hours.
the sweet sound of a V10 powering a Lamborghini Gallardo GT3 car with the very experienced Steve Owen behind the wheel. They currently sit third in the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour, 24 laps in the books, 1 hour and 3 minutes completed, 10 hours and 56 to go, and we're not too far away from that first pit window, which we're expecting now, thanks to the Mercedes safety car, somewhere between lap 28 and 32, just extend that first window on a little bit, as expected.
I think we might even get the 35, and one or two extra fuel allowances being given, particularly to the Mercedes-Benz. By the way, we were talking earlier on about depth of the field. I'm just going to read you the three names of drivers who are battling for 10th, 11th, 12th, and 14th as well. Ollie Govan, Maxi Burke, David Brabham, all battling for position. Oh, and add Guy Smith into that.
And Matt Holliday ahead of that, John. It's an astounding field here. It really has come from, well, more or less nowhere to being one of the great World GT races.
It's a must-do. The drivers will tell you now, it's a must-do race, and that's why Ollie Govan and David Brabham, who might be in his last professional race here. That we're still waiting for Brabs to confirm or deny that. He hasn't been named in the ESM squad for the WEC. I know he was considering whether he was going to go and do the longer races with them and possibly do Le Mans this year, but he's got Project Brabham up and running, of course. But what better way, if this is to be the swan song of David Brabham, with Sam Brabham, his son, and Matty Brabham, his nephew, starting their motor racing careers. As we look at Roger Largo. Excuse me, it's Steve Owen, isn't it, who's behind the wheel there.
I think looking at the pictures you're seeing on TV, the timing screens and trackside, John, there is a masterclass of fast GT racing going on at the moment from Marcus Vinkelhock. We talked, didn't we, as we've been sat in car at the moment with the number 32 car. But we talked a little earlier about just how close some of this racing is. But Marcus Vinkelhock is just pulling away almost at will at the moment. It's an astounding drive by Marcus Vinkelhock at this stage of the race.
Yeah, and these two running quite close together, the Nissan being chased by the very experienced Steve Owen, who raced with this team over at the Spa 24-hour last year. Roger Largo up and took his operation from the Brisbane suburbs to one of the biggest endurance races in the world, 24 hours of Spa. Stephen Richards, David Russell and car owner Roger Largo behind the wheel. They did a really good job too. They were the only Lamborghini in the field. It's a car out of favour in international GT3 racing, but still quite strong here in Australia. And Owen's adapted very, very nicely to this car this weekend. Owen's been focusing on the longer run in the setup and balance of this car. David Russell's been focusing on the speed, and Largo a little bit of everything just to make sure they've got the best all-round combination. We jump a little bit further up the order and ride on board the turbocharged Nissan GTR Nismo GT3. Wolfie Reap behind the wheel of car 35 plunges off the top of the hill. It'll be challenging for another half an hour or so there, because as you get to Skyline, to Brock Skyline, and dive off the hill, you're looking straight into the morning sun, almost due east, and then you plunge off the road. So with a dirty windscreen already, bugs being smashed against it for over an hour already, it will be very, very difficult to see just for that point of the racetrack. But it's a significant point because the road disappears and then there's a 1-in-6 gradient as it drops down towards the Falcon Tyres elbow. Down Conrod Straight, though, it's a great sound, and it'll be flat down here for the chase.
Let's have a listen. Had a feather there because of the TTRS in front of him. Amazing that you can hear that, though. So onboard cameras, I always associate, of course, Australian sport and particularly Channel 7 with bringing on the technology of onboards. We had seen nothing like it in Europe when we were watching racing from here. They never got it live in those days, of course. It was this time of the year, bizarrely, ironically.
It was the panning, passing cameras,
yeah,
wasn't it?
Absolutely.
Blew our minds back in the UK.
This was our winter motorsport. We'd see the James Hardy 1000 as it was in those days, around about January or February. And there's a certain irony that this Northeast England lad is now at the Mount Panorama circuit watching live motor racing and taking it to the world. With our colleagues.
Let's talk some movers and shakers. Christopher Meese has dragged the number 9 car, kicking and screaming, to fourth place from the bottom of the top 10 at the start of this motor race. The double winner of this race in 2011 and 2012 with Audi. He's been here every year it's been run as a GT race. He is a proper talent, the 25-year-old. and he's got himself up to fourth place. Was quickest for the first section of qualifying yesterday, the one-hour session when every single car was on the racetrack, but they couldn't translate that one-lap speed into the 20-minute session just for the outright cars that followed, and as a result, he tumbled from first place down to the bottom of the top 10, but he's making up for it in this early stint, putting his Bathurst experience to good use, knowing where to pass cars. He's been here five times now. He knows where the best places, the safest places are to make overtaking opportunities, and he's done a good job and got that car to fourth place. Young Richard Musket doing a superb job in fifth in the Erebus Motorsport SLS. Then we go back through the Aston Martin, Darrell O'Young, Clark Quinn, Guy Smith in the Bentley up to eighth. McIntyre and Maxi Book rounding out the top 10. We'll get another break out of the way as our coverage of the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour continues. And a beautiful Sunday here at Mount Panorama.
Lots of action out on the circuit, and none more so from Ollie Gavin's view. He's in the number five Audi. The white Bentley ahead of him is a pass for position, and they are in traffic, and they are in quick traffic as well. With due pit stops anytime soon, watch out for Stefan Ortelli bouncing up through the field. Remember, he pitted out a sequence in the number 16. He's in 20th position at the moment. It's Graham Goodwin, Richard Krill, and myself, John Hindorf, overlooking, oh, just beautiful, picture-perfect scenes here. And this is the battle for now 10th and 9th place. In fact, that's Maxi Burke who is ahead of him, because Guy Smith has just squeezed through the lap before. So the Bentleys have changed position and now are in 10th. 10 and 11 are in 8 and 9, and Ollie Gavin in 10th position. And this, Krillsy, is classic Bathurst. Through the traffic, through the morning sun, the rubbish on the windscreen. I mean, well, pick a side, any side, and just hope there's nothing there.
That's the visibility as you go off the top from Ollie Gavin's viewpoint in the Beechwood Homes entry. Meanwhile, our race leader sets a new race lap record, 203.3091 on lap 29. You get the impression perhaps pressing on before a pit stop to build that buffer as much as he can. The margin, 27 seconds now for our race leader, the German Marcus Winkelhock, who leads the race. But the Bentleys looking ominous, aren't they? Formation flying their way into the top 10. Guy Smith in eighth, Maxi Book in ninth. We're watching them from Ollie Gavin in 10th in the Audi R8, which was easy flat through the kink at the Michelin Chase.
Yeah, very easy indeed. Little bit of a brow on the road there between the two parts of the chase. It means you take a slightly odd looking line. It's not a classic racing line there, is it? You crest the brow before you turn into the right hander, and now there's a bit of traffic, and this could be Ollie Gavin's opportunity again. It's economy of movement on the steering wheel, just flicking with the fingers, second finger down, left hand side to change down, right hand side to go up as they go past the Ginetta G50, one of the GT4 cars, and hazard flashes going on the car ahead. That actually might be, I don't know what that is. Might just be the camera picking up the frame rate of the LED rear lights, actually. That's a little bit off-putting for us as commentators, but not being seen by the human eye of Ollie Gavin through Griffin's Bend and climbing up towards the area. This is a great shot, looking straight down. And this is where you really see how much the driver, look at everything moving around the driver. You can see all the leads and everything that's plugged in, the G-forces are being applied to them. Look how stable the driver is with his hands device with the straps down. That looks actually quite comfortable, doesn't it?
It looks almost like a simulator, doesn't it? Until you look at all the peripherals and the G-forces throwing them around. We're entering another phase of this race, guys, with one or two of the A-class cars coming in now to change over from the starting drivers to perhaps the more amateur, the more gentleman drivers. We've seen the 27 car down pit road, the 51 Porsche now in, and I suspect out by the time I've said this. And what you're beginning to see too here is these guys blasting by the A-class cars in traffic. So another factor with the cars very quick in a straight line, but perhaps the less professional drivers unable to keep the pace through the tight and twisty bits.
And if you are just joining us, first of all, where have you been and have you got a note for being late? Secondly, it's been a record-breaking weekend here. We've seen the fastest ever competitively recorded lap here in qualifying yesterday, and now the lap record's gone here as far as the GT cars is concerned. 203.3091 by Winkelhock in the Phoenix car at the head of the field. Marvellous stuff.
Half a second quicker than the lap that blew everybody away. We've got a Bentley on pit lane, blew everybody away from Shane van Gisbergen last year.
It's the 11 car pits. So Maximilian Book brings the car in. Was just about to talk about this fight because Clark Quinn was starting to back up towards them in the Darrell Lee McLaren 12C in seventh place. Guy Smith now behind him. Ollie Gavin gets released. We've also seen the 27 car pit, the Trask Family Racing entry from New Zealand. They were reporting a loose front splitter on that car. So they pitted on lap 29, tried to get as long as they could into their fuel window to get into pit lane so they don't go too far out of sequence. The number 51 iMac Racing Porsche also has stopped on lap 29. So Book in and David Brabham follows in the Flying B.
It was a close formation Bentley pit stop there with the Flying B car run by the Maranello Motorsport team, remember. So Mark Goff and his boys still busy, despite the fact we've not got the 88 Ferrari on the grid. Two Bentleys on pit road, and I think it's going to get busy underneath us very soon.
This is a battle for track position. You're watching Clark Quinn in the orange McLaren. Behind them, Guy Smith and Ollie Gavin. A couple of guys who have won at the highest level at Le Mans. These two are two of the very best international GT drivers going around. They're chasing a guy who races part-time. He runs a chocolate sweets company full-time. Clark runs the Darrell Lee business and has turned it around over the last 4 or 5 years. They're putting a lot of pressure on, but Clark is doing a good job. He is an Australian GT champion. He knows how to drive these cars.
Darrell Lee, an Australian classic and a legend, and Clark Quinn really impressed me last year when he was dicing with the international field, and he's pulling away a little bit. The very slippery mid-engined McLaren gets just a little bit of an advantage from the bluffer shape of the Bentley down the Conrod straight there. V8 in the front of the Bentley. Has Ollie Gavin got squeezed there behind? Now, did he hold on to that? Yes, I think I can just see the shadow as he came through the Michelin chase. And Smithy's in the pit lane, so he bails out of this.
That's the Clearwater Racing Ferrari. They were putting a lap on. This is a car that qualified in the top six, the Nissan pits too. So too does third place Steve Owen, fourth place Christopher Meese. They're right in the window. They've got to lap 31. And this was busy across the top of Mount Panorama. The Nissan with a very, very near miss.
Heck of a save from Wolfie Reap. That is cat-like reflexes. And a cat that has been practicing its reflexes as well.
That was with Peter Conroy in the number 14 Porsche, just going a lap down. So we've got to lap 31 for the fuel window. That safety car has helped. It's drawn them longer into the race. Reap, Owen and Meese in pit lane, third, fourth and fifth place all in.
No tyres for that car there, and this is what we were hearing, double stinting at least on the early set of tyres. You don't have to start the race on the tyres that you qualify on here. A little bit of, now somebody's been off there. It was the Rickshaw Racing in the GWS class BMW spreading a whole load of freshly cut grass onto the racing line up the mountain straight as Wolfie Reef rejoins.
And leader yet to stop, JH.
Yeah, he's so doing well.
Winkelhock going well. The Audis have always been economical in this race. They continue to pound around. Winkelhock leads. Mark Beretta is in pit lane.
David Brabham made a pretty quick stop there. Fuel only put in 113 litres and then took off again. But he has a highly experienced crew with him, led by Campbell Little, who's looking after the Bentley for him at the moment. But the atmosphere in here is very, very enthusiastic. John Bauer, who you know, gets excited about his racing. He's very pumped about where the car is, the way it's going, the way David's driving it at the moment, and JB can't wait to get in.
The white suits you, Barrettes.
Thank you very much. I wouldn't say it's my best colour.
Cheers, Barrettes. Working hard with Jay Adam down in the pit lane. Good morning, or good evening, should I say, because it's 10 past 8 in the UK, to Marino Franchitti, who's tuned in on the international stream here, and one of many racing drivers who are sitting at the moment going, hang on, why am I not there? Marino, you would love racing in this atmosphere. And Al Book has just been on Twitter as well, as Jan Mardenborough, two of the Nismo athletes who are very much in tune with this car. And Al, good to hear your good news about the new edition. We miss you here, but take some family time, mate. I know you've got a busy summer coming up with your driving commitments.
And the last couple of years, this number 35 car, this Nissan GTR, has been so much a part of the story here at the Bathurst 12 Hours. Another name that's been part of this the story has been Simonsen, and Benny Simonsen has been one of the latest pit stoppers from Class A. Benny started that vicious room in the 49 car from 50th position. He was up to 14th position by the time he made his first pit stop. So 36 cars passed.
Maguire's replay, spinning Lamborghini. That's Steve Owen.
Yes, it is.
Spins the 32 car on the exit of the Michelin Chase.
He's going to be furious that our excellent camera team caught that, because he could have explained that one away. Nobody would have seen that. You can't run, you can't hide with our guys here on the mountain doing a cracking job. You just see that little bit of dirt and debris. As the leader finally pits on lap number 33, right in the middle of that window that Krilzy was talking about. So that is going to leave Richard Muscat leading the motor race in the 36. And where has Stefano Telli then bounced up to, having made his stop?
Stefan is in 13th position, almost 2 minutes behind the leader. He's still on the top of the mountain.
Don't expect my maths to be that accurate for the rest of the day. We got lucky there.
Minute and 57 seconds, he was behind the leader when the 15 car came down pit road.
He's gone a lot longer than thought he would. Of course, that safety car helped, but he's gone a lap longer.
Oh, trouble for the other
two rivals. Yeah, Justin McMillan has spun the car. These guys out of sequence. They stopped on lap six. So there's six laps, the difference to the race leaders. Stephen Richards started the car just to get it through that pretty hairy pre-dawn period. And Justin McMillan, who owns the M Motorsport team, behind the wheel. Maguire's replay will show what happened. Oh, no, that's what happened to...
That's the Lamborghini. Spot, different side of the road.
Two Lamborghinis spinning on the exit of the chase.
We'll have to call that Lambo Corner from now on.
Harmless moment, though.
Richard Muscat, Darrell O'Young, Clark Quinn and Ollie Gavin have all pitted following the leader down pit lane. And the next car through should be Nathan Gawalkham, and I think he's going to take the lead, guys.
Stays out on the road. The 63 now, car started 19th.
They've got extra fuel, of course, and they can go longer. I wonder if they've been playing this game right from the start. We always talk about potentially saving fuel. You can't just make up your mind to do that in the last five laps of your stint. You've got to start off with the fuel saving in mind. And at the start of the race, when you're going to get quite a lot of bunching up, when you're going to get potential for the safety car being out there, that wouldn't have been a bad call to say, don't run the full rich map. Let's just coast a little bit, try and make a couple of laps or so, and that basically gives us more options, Krilzy, of what we do when we get into the meat of the race.
And we haven't seen too much in the way of tyres being changed, have we? It's basically fuel only, and the occasional driver change, as expected, the tyres are not being worn too much. Three compounds for each brand this weekend, two competing brands. It's a proper war, the tyre war this weekend, Michelin versus Pirelli, to the point where the global boss of Pirelli Motor Racing, their Formula One boss, Paul Hembree, was here on Friday and came directly from the most recent Formula One test at Jerez in Spain and came down here just to make sure his product was going okay. They are the fastest tyre before this weekend, at least around Mount Panorama with Vankersbergen last year.
This is the richest Class C leaders, the Battleship Grey almost. It looks fantastic in the sunshine. It's got a little pearl finish underneath. This is the St. Gallen Aston Martin. Chris Porritt returning to the mountain, a former Aston Martin test driver, the man who took me around the Nürburgring the first time and then was either brave or stupid enough to stay in while I took my first quick laps around there. Good to see Chris back now, the VP of Vehicle Dynamics and Engineering at Tesla Motors over in Fremont, California. Chris reunited with the Aston Martin Vantage, a great little weapon around here in the Ridges category. By the way, I just had a tweet from Sam Brabham who says, thanks for the mention, Hindy. How about Brabs Racer, which is David, his dad, Matty Brabs, his cousin, Matthew, all in the same car next year on the mountain?
That'd be quite nice.
Let's make that happen.
That'd be quite nice.
I'm going to throw another one out there as well.
Meantime, as we watch the number 76 car continue around, Marcus Vinkelhock has come round, still in the lead, 9 seconds ahead of Nathan Morecambe, who's now up to second, owes us a pit stop. But I think we're going to go down and talk to Brett in a bit.
All right, Pat Long,
just down to the ice break. Porsche, that is one way to start the morning up on the mountain. How was it early on this morning?
Yeah, there was no jet lag this morning. 18 other monkeys in front of me going for broke. I mean, they were bouncing off each other right and left. So we just tried to stay clean. We've had a heck of a week with the ice break car, and it's running well, but I'm taking the more conservative approach. We could have doubled the tires, but we didn't have enough data. So we're going to be there at the end and not get caught up in all the ego fight.
Pat, tell us about this circuit in the morning. I mean, we know what a difficult, challenging circuit it is during daytime, but when you throw yourselves up there at nighttime under headlight, what's it like?
Well, it was a new experience, that's for sure. Actually, with a bunch of cars in front of you, you're really following the leader, and it illuminates it a bit. But certainly a memorable experience. Running Bathurst at 5 in the morning is something I'll tell stories about when people aren't remembering me. But we're having a great time. We obviously want to win this race for all of our partners, but we're also here to enjoy ourselves and keep our eye on the prize. It's easy to get caught up in, as I said.
Give us a feel for the Porsche. How's it handling for you?
You know, this car is long in the tooth. It's about the 6th year this car has been in action as a GT3R from our 997 model designation. We have a new car coming next year, so we know that it's reliable, but it's not quite up there with the latest update specs of the Audis and the McLarens, etc. But, you know, as I said, it's good in the low-speed corners. We've got a lot of traction, great braking, but across the mountain, we give up a little bit of time. But in the end, when you get into traffic, it's not that big of a deal because no one's on the ragged edge, so it really becomes about traffic management. Right now, the slower cars have their best drivers in, so it's pretty manageable. When they start circulating through into their lesser experienced drivers, you're going to see a lot more hairy instances, and hopefully everybody will just stay to one line, and we'll all get through this.
Now, we know it's a big, long day, but what's your expectation? Where would you like to finish? What's a good result?
I mean, a podium, we'd be pouring iced coffee all over each other, but realistically, anything inside the top 10 is a feat for everybody today. There's 20 cars that can win this race today, and that's a lot about the race. It's drawing a lot of experienced teams and drivers. It's a great time of the season. Things are quiet over in Europe. We don't start till May, so hopefully this will be one of the regular season hold races for GT3. I think it's a great worldwide platform where you can bring your car from all ends of the world, whether it's Australian GT or Blancpain in Europe. We brought our car from the U.S., so yeah, let's keep doing this. It's a lot of fun. It's always good to be in Australia.
Pat, it's great to have you here. You deserve an ice break. Go for it.
Thank you.
Very nice, Barrett. Well done. And how's the sponsor placement halfway through the interview? Casually drinks from his ice break iced coffee.
He's a pro.
Ultimate professional, Patrick Long. Great to have him here. Let's have a look at where things stand in the running order for the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour. Thanks to Michelin, Marcus Winklehock continues to lead. Nathan Morecambe has just pitted, so he's dropping down the order a little bit. Steve Owen back in the 10. Ortelli up to P5 in car 16.
He's already pitted, of course.
Pit stop shuffling through Musket, Smith, O'Young, Brabham, and Steve Wyatt in the AF Corsa car back inside the top 10 now as the race continues an hour and 29 into the 2015 Liqui Moly 12-hour. Thanks to Pirelli. This is how the class standings run. It's Winklehock, Morecambe, Yulden. The Aston Martin St. Gallen entry continues to lead Richards Class C. They're going very well. The Daytona leads Class D. Jake Camilleri leading the Recaro Invitational. A break from the mountain and more from the 12-hour next.
Middle of the pit stop cycle here at Mount Panorama with an hour and 32 gone. Let's head down there now and share Adam.
And Oliver Gavin just got out from behind the wheel of the Squirtworks Audi. We're used to seeing you in a Corvette. You were in an Audi here last year. Is it very similar driving the Audi here last year to how it was?
Well, certainly the car we drove last year, the 2011 car, was a little bit lighter on downforce than the 2014 car. But it's fantastic to drive. It's great. I mean, it's got a good amount of low speed and medium speed corner speed. The high speed stuff, it's still solid as well. We just seem to be lacking a little bit in straight line speed. You know, I had a great race with Guy Smith and the other. I think it was Suchek and the other Bentley, and they've just got a little bit too much go for us on the straight. So we've got to work away and. You find an opening. It was pretty racy on those first few laps, quite hard to see, but managed to sort of make my way up from sort of 23rd up to 12th. Then there was the safety car, and then that restart, I got a little bit mugged going to turn one, and I had a couple of guys blast past me up the straight, going up mountain straight into two. But yeah, you know, there's plenty of time to go. There's plenty of racing to happen, and our car seems to be pretty good. Seems to hang on to the tyre reasonably well. So, you know, I think we're in a good spot. Rod's just out of the car now. I think he might do a double, and then Nathan will get in and maybe do a double after that, and then I'll be back in.
We've been tweeting with Jordan Taylor all morning, who's dying to get here. Do you have any special message for your Le Mans teammate?
Yeah, grow the mullet.
There you go. Who have you got, Brett?
For our Australian audience that might not know that reference, apologies, down to Mark Beretta.
I've got the First Lady of Australian Motorsport with me, Betty Clemenko. Betty, great to see you here. I know you're enjoying the race. You've done a great campaign this year. You've got some really young, exciting drivers in the team.
Yes, we do, and it's actually really relaxing to have them there because it's just a feeling of letting them go up there, show the world what they've got, and not have to worry about those big important men. It's the only way I can say it. But thank you for calling me the First Lady.
Do you like that?
I love it.
All right, well, let's make that stick. Betty, why did you want to go with the young guys? Why did you want to bring the youth up through the sport?
I believe that every couple of years you got to do something like this. You've got to forget about the podiums, forget about all the glory, and just showcase what we have here. Yes, one of them's a young American. He's only 16. But he compliments the drivers we have in the car. And, you know, there's 120 million people out there watching, and maybe one guy will say, that's the driver I want. And sometimes you just got to show the youth and say, here we are, come and take us.
And they do, they are holding their own. I mean, their performance so far is fantastic. What are we, last time I looked, we were sitting fifth, so going well.
Richard's the GT champion, so he's an old GT pro, but in a very young body. And the others are doing really well. I mean, Austin is just, you know, blown us all away for 16. He is doing amazingly.
Can you pick a favourite, Betty? Do you have a favourite?
No. I've gone the black and the white. I mean, the cars are meant to represent the yin and the yang of the sport. So it's a nice balance today, and I've decided. But my husband's taken over GT, so he knows all the technical bits. I'm a passenger today.
Well, sit back and enjoy. Always good to talk to the First Lady. Thanks,
lovely
Betty.
To see you.
Yeah, let's get that hashtag going. Betty Clemenko, hashtag First Lady. Bad news at turn one, Hell Corner. And that is the Peter Conroy Motorsport machine. The Porsche looking very, very deranged on right front and right rear as well.
It's Peter Conroy.
Well, the man with his name over the door has been the car in the kitty litter, and that's been a big hit. Look at the troughs in the gravel that's gone in hard, and that's brought out the AMG safety car again. The Mercedes-Benz back out on the circuit. Guys driving the safety car, loving it, by the way. Cool seats, great sound system, listening to us on 87.8 around the circuit, and the sharp end of 500 horsepower under the right foot. That's the way to have a safety car drive. A
couple of Class A cars taking the opportunity of the safety car to rumble down pit lane. Krelzy, I think that was a 32 car. And was that Stefano Ortelli as well?
It was. So third and fourth place have decided
Smart.
To go off sequence
again.
Just get themselves and unjumble themselves from the order. So the 16 car was already off sequence. Steve Owen, though, was playing the game with everybody else. But they've decided to take a gamble and stop that car, top it off with fuel, and go a little bit longer into the next stint and execute a driver change as well, because we can show you that from inside the JBS Racing Lamborghini. Steve Owen getting out, Roger Largo getting in. Very experienced competitor in Australian GT and Porsche Carrera Cup Australia Racing. So he straps himself into the Lamborghini. They'll put a full tank of fuel, over 100 litres in these fuel tanks, and go again. Unfortunately for Peter Conroy, who put together a very strong team in car number 14. Of course, Grant Denyer, who lives locally in between his various commitments around the world, and continues to live here and often goes for a run around the circuit. You get a lot on Instagram of him focusing his efforts at this place, getting fit and healthy to go racing. Replay, have a look at the top of your screen.
Straight off.
And at a great degree of knots as well. And he's barreled off into the sand trap and made quite heavy contact. You can see where it's driven straight into the signage there on the side at turn one at Hell Corner.
So that's a shame for a car that we thought would be at least a contender for the Class B. Honest, gee, some of them have had some issues already in Class B, thanks to Century Batteries. The pole sitter in that class, Marcus Marshall, got done for a drive-through penalty after the first safety car this morning for overlapping on the restart. So a safety car infringement, restart infringement, and had to serve a drive-through penalty. Through it all, the number four car continues to chip away.
And a bit of fluid just out of the back of the Audi R8 there. This is one of the Pirelli tyres runners, Pirelli and Michelin, on the well, it's a war. It's a tyre war. There's no doubt about it here.
75 car, John. James Winslow in that car at the moment.
A bit of dry ice going. Now, that was interesting. What looked like the big tube of drinks cups going into the side of the car wasn't. It was dry ice going down into the cool suit provider for the driver. So dry ice going in there, and then the water gets pumped around and chills it down. Well, we're still on clean-up here. We've had an hour and 40 minutes exactly. Marcus Finkelhock leads at the mountain in the 15. Abruptly enough, it's got a roux on the side of that Phoenix Audi. It's the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 hours for 2015. We're still working this full course cautioned at the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 hours for 2015. Porsche in the gravel at turn one being recovered at the moment, and we should say a great big thank you to all of our corner workers who've been doing such a good work here this weekend. And a busy first, what, hour and 45 minutes, Creelzy?
How are we already that far into the race? And there's only 10 hours and 15 minutes to go. We started in the dark of a beautiful Bathurst morning, and it was a mad rush into turn one. It's called Hell Corner for a reason, and that's why it was busy in the middle. The brakes were working hard on some of the production class cars. This was a big move. Down the inside, David Brabham in the Flying V Racing Bentley gave his old mate Stefan Ortelli a hip and shoulder out of the way. There were dramas at the cutting. Mark King aboard the Mazda RX-8, American endurance race car from the Grand Am series, spun and had a very, very close call with another entry as he recovered himself onto the racetrack. That didn't bring out the first safety car. However, it wouldn't be too far away. A sad end to car number 42. Anthony Gilbertson behind the wheel of the Motivate Racing BMW M3 GTR. Unfortunately, Skippy caused that car to pull to the side of the road. Pete Story was behind the wheel of the Compare Insurance Aston Martin. It spun at the chase, but no massive dramas, and they resumed and continued on. And then we got into the pit stop shuffle. That car had another spin up the top of Mountain Straight, just ticking off both sides of the 6.2-kilometre circuit for a gyration. And they had some issues getting that car recovered, but managed to get back into the motor race. Car number 52, the former British Touring Car champion Gordon Shedden, part of that crew as well. This was a hairy moment. The race leader, Marcus Winkelhock, behind the wheel of the 15 car, and Richard Gartner in the Porsche got out into the marbles and whacked the wall heavily. Just at McPhillamy Park, Wolfie Reek looked down the inside of the Mark Cars Australia Mazda V8, and then the top just before the pit stop shuffle began. And then he said a hairy moment with the 14 car that has brought out this current safety car. Steve Owen pitted the Lamborghini and then spun promptly on slightly colder tyres on the exit of the chase on his first full lap out. And the chase, the Michelin chase, has been action-packed because just a few laps later, the other Lamborghini with Justin McMillan behind the wheel had a spin as well. So as they run, Marcus Winkelhock, the German, continues to lead as he has done since the opening lap of the motor race. Wolfgang Rink is second for Nissan, and Richard Muscat, the young Aussie Australian GT champion, doing an outstanding job in third place for Erebus Motorsport. And we heard from Betty Klimenko before the break about the youth policy they've taken. This is the first lady of motorsport, we should say, down in
hashtag
pit lane.
First lady.
Correct. And doing a great job, Richard Muscat, with Jack LeBrock and Dean Canto to get in that car still to come today. They are contenders. Bentley sits fourth with Guy Smith, the Le Mans 24-hour winner, behind the wheel. And Darryl Young, twice a winner of this race, fifth in the number 97 Aston Martin. So to recap that, it's Audi, Nissan, Mercedes, Bentley, Aston Martin, running inside the top five.
That's pretty decent, isn't it? There is the Porsche, the pit stop car that we saw earlier on with the issues. Still being worked on, it's a never say die attitude here. I'm sure they'll try and get that car back out. A number of people who aren't here who should be. Lawrence Tomlinson has been called out from Ginetta by a number of people. Let's have a G55 down here. In the GT4 class.
I think we've got one, haven't we? We've got a GT3 car in the Australian GT Championship this year.
Yeah.
We do. It'd be great to see that here next year.
Yeah, I've had a go, thanks to Lawrence and Ginetta, in their Super Cup with a G55, with the endurance car, and it would be perfect around here. And I'm just going to put this out here, because I know one of these three, I think, is going to be here today. How about Patrick Dempsey, who wants to do this race. Eric Banner, we know, has done it before. Can't do it this year. And I know Eric's been tuned in over the weekend. He's got actual work to do this weekend. He's a part-time actor, full-time driver.
Fantastic.
He tweeted to me early on. And Mark Webber. How about those three in a Porsche?
What's he been in?
Here next year. He's done some endurance racing. Out the lights then on the safety car, the Mercedes-Benz AMG SLS 63 disappears. Down the road, CLS 63, should I say, disappears down the road. That means that the field once again becomes all down to Marcus Vingelhoek. Wolfie Reap again with lapped cars between him will be rather cursing his luck, I think, at the moment. And the reason for that, and we'll say this again for people just joining us on 7 Mate, and we'll be live on 7 later on today, is no passing before the start-finish line. And in fact, not even any overlapping before there either, and Wolfie will be absolutely fuming that gaps have opened up between the first 5-6 cars. He's not even in the shot there, as Marcus Vingelhoek gets a clean and clear run across the line and heads up mountain straight. He's going to just disappear into the distance. All those cars behind. There's Wolfie just getting a little bit squirrely coming through the first turn and heading up mountain straight, and he's got some quick cars around him, including Pat Long's Porsche.
And Richard Muscat's SLS, which is the battle for position for second place. There's 3 or 4 seconds between those two cars. But already, Vingelhoek, 4.7 seconds, first to second at the line when they got the green flag. So for the second time today, 2 safety car interruptions by the Mercedes-Benz safety car. 2 times, Vingelhoek has benefited and got a massive lead, and most importantly of all, clear air and clear racetrack in front of him.
And after some problems earlier on, the Grove Motorsport car, the number 4 Porsche, leads at its category, the Century Batteries GT3. Ben Barker at the wheel of that, the man who won at Le Mans in the Porsche Cup race for Par Motorsport. And hello to all of the guys back in the south of England. Paul Robe and the rest of the team will be watching this very carefully indeed.
Shuffling going on. There's been changes. Darrell O'Young has been moved back to 6th place. David Brabham moves to P5. The Flying V Racing entry has charged his way up to the order.
He's actually up into 4th position now, is Brabs. Although that's changed again, Guy Smith. So the two Bentleys are duking it out there. It's still Wolfgang Reap is trying to find his way through this traffic. 5 cars between him as the cars pass the start-finish line. He needs to get on the back end of this little train and get his head down, doesn't he?
And these guys, remember, are not in the right spot on the track as far as the timing and scoring for them is concerned. They're a little bit off the leader's pace at the moment, but that doesn't stop them racing for track position. And the Porsche just doesn't have the ponies on the Audi in front of it.
Oh, big crash.
This is the 51 iMac car. Not the first time we've seen this car in strife over the weekend. It's been around a couple of times. And behind it
is the
Mobile One car. It's the remaining team class, the 36, isn't it?
66.
The 66. The remaining car, the GT endurance machine.
And safety car immediately.
Falcon tyres, elbow claims victims.
Frank Lyons behind the wheel of the Mobile One GT3 endurance outfit. They have had a wretched start to the weekend, the New Zealand team. Unfortunately, some of their drivers, they had 2 cars entered, some of their drivers were injured in a road accident in Bathurst during the week, an unfortunate incident. They remain in hospital and our thoughts are with them. We understand they are on the mend. They consolidated their outfit into 1 car, the father and son, Frank and Michael Lyons. They brought in Chris van der Drift. Unfortunately, Frank Lyons behind the wheel, shown in that car at the moment, is stuck. But the 51 car, Andrew McPherson's Porsche, they have been somewhat of a dark horse this weekend. Matt Campbell and Brad Shields, the Bathurst local, have done a superb job. Andrew McPherson behind the wheel, shown in 24th place. currently parked against the tyre barriers up there at the Falcon Tyres elbow at the top of Conrod Straight. And as such, the third safety car is out. And there's an old saying we drag out here at Mount Panorama every year, no matter what the race meeting, safety cars breed safety cars. And we've just seen proof of that today.
Yep. Yellows mean yellows. There is the BMW also in pit lane. This is the little one series car that's had hit its fair share of issues this weekend, the 18 car.
That's their backup car, John, remember.
Correct, the T car, 18T, the Sharon Reynolds 135i.
Crashed heavily on Saturday morning there. Second car, fortunately, they had the spare in the truck, dusted it off, changed the numbers and sent it out. Nice to have a T car in the garage.
The Queensland family racing team, the Sharons, a long history and great history in motorsport.
So Marcus Winkelhock leads under our third caution period. Let's go down to Shay Adam.
Richard Gardner is the driver who was behind the wheel of that yellow Porsche that hit the wall very, very hard earlier on to avoid the leading number 15 Audi. And Richard, you were behind the wheel of the car. Sorry to interrupt. You were behind the wheel of the car at the time. Take us through what your perspective was.
Well, basically, there was a couple of us going over Reed Park. And look, essentially, the Audi just dived inside me. I know they are fighting for the lead, but we are fighting as well. And look, there just wasn't enough room for two cars, I believe, at that time. And so that pushed me onto the dirt a little bit. And once you're in the dirt, well, really, you're a passenger. You know, I'm not quite sure if he actually touched or not, but it was just one of those things. It's a motor racing incident, I guess. And, you know, look, the team is putting the car back together. What can we do?
How long before the car is back together?
We're hoping in the next 5 or 10 minutes that it's actually ready again. So it just bent the subframe. We got a great team behind us. Wall Racing is going to fix that car. And then we're going to soldier on and see where we're going to get to.
And we were talking about how chaotic it is out there, beyond even what you experienced at that one incident. How was the start?
The start was chaotic because I think what we have is a lot of different kind of cars. So you have the really downforce GT3 cars, who of course got an enormous amount of corner speed. And then you have a Porsche that is actually on a straight line just as quick. And then we had, I think, a Daytona Sports in there who goes like the clapper. But man, you know, and so there is so many different kind of cars in it. Into turn one, actually, I chose to go out into the grass and to avoid some chaos out there. And then, you know, just hanging in there, and you just, yeah, pick them up as it goes, and, you know, and then you have kangaroos on the track, and gosh, you know, that's badass.
Track throws everything at you, including Barretts. Who have you got further down?
Well, with Felix Baumgartner now, the man, of course, who jumped out of space and has most recently flown over our mountain. What do you think of the place, Felix?
Well, it's a very demanding, unforgiving racetrack. It takes a lot of courage to drive here, and if you make a little mistakes, you know, it adds up a lot of seconds. So I'm still working on my skills here because this is the first time. So since, until yesterday, I have been a Panorama Mountain virgin, you know, but not anymore.
Not anymore. Now, I'm hearing great things about your performance over the weekend. Of course, most importantly, keeping the car away from the walls and bring the times down lap by lap, which is exactly what you want to be doing.
Yeah, that's what I'm working on. You have to find the thin balance between not risking too much, but you have to attack, otherwise the time is not going down. But the car has to stay in shape because I have to hand it over to my teammates because this is a 12-hour race. So I have to shut down my ego and I have to be a smart competitor.
Yeah. So you bring the same focus that you had really on the space jump to motorsport.
Well, it's pretty much same, pretty much based on the same principles. You know, you got to be focused. You have to have confidence in your team, confidence in the technique, and last but not least, confidence in yourself.
And you have to stay away from those kangaroos, which you have done so far.
I have never saw one, but I'm sitting in a crocodile car, so that helps.
It's a beautiful car, too. The design, if people haven't seen it yet, the design of the car with the crocodile and the Australian wildlife on the side is fantastic. Where did that come from?
It's an idea that came from Audi. It's a tribute to a race that they did a couple of years ago. It was a very successful race, and now they came back with the crocodile.
Yeah. Fantastic. And Felix, you look like you're having a good time here.
Oh, yeah, I'm really enjoying it, you know. It's the experience. I always like the journey, you know. It's not just the success because probably not going to be successful here. I can never win this race. But I like the build-up. I can listen and learn from all these guys, and probably next year I'll be back and with a better score.
Yeah. Are there parallels between the work, the process you went through with the space jump and getting your head around the mountain and racing the car here?
Oh yeah, definitely. You know, it's the focus that you put into something. You know, it's the talk with all the other race car drivers because they can give you so many good advices, you know, that helped me a lot. And it's the practicing, so there's a lot of similarities to Red Bull Stratos because we did the exact same thing. We started from scratch, and then we slowly built up the progress, you know, and at the very end, it was a good performance.
Felix, it's great to see you here. Great to see you having success, and enjoy your day at the mountain.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, man.
So we're under full course caution. The AMG safety car is out for an incident up at the Falcon Tyres elbow. And the good news is, Abaguire's replay called it all. Just watch here. The IMAC car loses it on the inside and spears back across the road. And I've got to say, unfortunately for the GD3 endurance guys, they had nothing to do with that. They just minded their own business. That's what happens here when you've got nowhere to go.
Yeah, innocent victim, I think, Frank Lyons in the Mobil 1 car. And it's easy to do that there. We've seen it before. You lose the rear, the camber change on the road, and fire it across into the wall on the outside. So that's a shame for those two cars. They look pretty badly damaged. We're under safety car, the Mercedes-Benz safety car at the Liquid Moly Bathurst 12-hour, approaching the two-hour mark on the mountain. Winklehock leads from Reap and Musket. We'll take a break and be back with more shortly.
Trying to make positions, and bad news for the 66 GT3 Endurance Racing guys. They've had a horrid week already with some of their drivers involved in a road traffic accident. Nothing to do with them, and we wish them the best. They've had to consolidate their team into one car rather than two. Beautifully turned out and presented cars. Now let's look behind the AMG safety car to check out where the leaders are. Well, there's Wolfie Reap in second place, and he has got fewer cars between him, Graham, than he had before.
It was five or six before at the green flag. It's three now. Rather sad to see those two Porsches. Bit of a family feud there. Sisters getting it together on the mountain, I'm afraid. But three cars between the Phoenix Audi, we can see weaving from side to side behind the safety car, then two further Audis, then the icebreak Porsche, then it's Wolfgang Reap.
Yeah, now, how helpful are any of those guys going to be? They're trying, of course, to get back on the lead lap. They just lost it when the full course caution came out. The tactics are playing. Stefano Telli in the number 16 car in seventh position as we see the remains of the iMac car dumped back into Parc Fermé, the dead car park.
I'm really sad about this car being out because they were on my list of perhaps not outright winners, but dark horses for a podium, and certainly victory in the amateur class within Class A, thanks to Darrell Lee. They were very, very strong. Brad Shields, I think, has done a remarkable job. Young Bathurst driver. Mm-hmm. He's the only truly local driver from this town in the field. He's done an outstanding job. Matt Campbell, who's from Warwick in Queensland, about 3 hours inland from Brisbane, a racing town. They've got a racetrack up there called Morgan Park. His granddad runs it. It's a fantastic facility. Matt's got lots of time up there, lots of time behind the wheel. He was driving before he could walk. Amazing driver, but unfortunately they will take no further part in this race. But they had a strong combination.
They did. There is one other factor, by the way, guys, that will hopefully, well, we hope play to a closer battle for the lead here, in that all the cars between the leader and second place in this train are Class A cars this time. So they're on the restart, those cars between should be quicker.
Yes, is that good or bad for Wolfie, though? Because it's going to be hard. He's got less of a speed differential to get by them. They're going to have to help.
But the problem with Wolfie last time around when it went to green was there was a big gap. There was that big gap that opened
up with the smaller
Porsche in front of the Nissan. He had to not only not overtake before the line, but then he had a heck of a bridge to cross once he'd actually got by.
I wonder if there's a deal to be done, and whether Bob Neville might be just wandering up and saying, right, guys, it's early on in the race, let's not play silly so-and-sos. Give our guy, you know, let the dog see the rabbit, as it were, and let the car go.
But the problem is, of course, they'll be wanting to get by the leader and get back on the lead lap.
So Marcus Winkelhock leads. It's Audi in front. The Nissan continues to run strongly in second, and they'll be happier this year than they were 12 months ago. That car was out very early in the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour, and a lot of determination from the Nismo camp to return this year and to at least get further into the race. But they've got a result targeted, and their three drivers in that car are very, very strong. The Erebus Motorsport car in third place. Looking good, Richard Musket, Guy Smith in Bentley in fourth. And haven't they crept up on it this morning? They have just pounded around relentlessly.
It's a bit stealthy, isn't it?
Yeah, but they've done it by stealth. They're fourth. Guy Smith fourth, David Brabham fifth, Darrell O'Young sixth for Aston Martin, Ortelli seventh. Remember, he and the car behind, Roger Largo, are on an alternate strategy. They stopped a little bit later in the second safety car in the race. Harold Primat up to ninth place in the second of the entries. Harold will be familiar to Bathurst 12-hour fans. He was here last year, part of that car that finished second, then a Mercedes-Benz SLS. And from 19th to 10th, the number 63 Erebus Motorsport car, the young gun car. Nathan Morecambe did the opening stint. They've plugged Simon Hodge, who remains the fastest ever driver in a race around here. He's the outright lap record holder with a 202.6 in a Formula 3 race here last year.
However,
in 10th place.
If we get a perfect lap from the sector times, a 2 or 2.3 is already on the cards and, from earlier on.
And two of those three sectors were done by the same Audi. Mm. It's the Nissan that's been quickest down the mountain. We're going to be coming back round to green, aren't we, John?
We are, and the crowds around the mountain have already had their money's worth. Good morning to you if you are just joining us on 7Mate or around the world on our international stream here at the circuit as well, of course. Great to see so many families here this weekend. It is rapidly becoming one of New South Wales' finest tourist attractions and an event that has built its reputation in a very short time indeed. Delighted to be here once again representing the international audience, and the Mercedes-Benz is in the pit lane, and we've got a very tightly packed field coming down to Maguire's. Murray's the final corner, and through underneath the Liqui Moly Bridge, we look to our left and see the green flag being waved by one of the 500 marshals who are here this weekend, and the huge amount of horsepower is unleashed once again. Wolfie Reeves just not getting involved with the three guys ahead of the two Bentleys go through in fine formation.
Now we need to get through this first lap, because we've seen already that the safety cars breed safety cars, two in quick succession. The last thing this field needs now is a third, because already tyres and brakes are cold. But the other thing that's cold can sometimes be the organic component. They just need to tune the brain up a little bit and get themselves focused and switched on to racing. And often it's not so much the cars that cause the safety cars, it's a bit of a brain fade that can cause dramas. So they just need to get settled in. They need two or three laps in a row to get bunkered down in their car and get some laps under their belt.
It's about 4 seconds now. It was two at the line for Wolfie Reeve. And his problem now is he's got Richard Muscat right at his tailpipes.
But he's got by one of the three cars that were in front. He's now got two cars between him and the overall leader, with the number 9 Audi and the number 12 Porsche the gap. But you're absolutely right, John. It is the 36 car, Richard Muscat, is the factor now. 15 from 35 from 36 up on the top of the mountain with these two cars. This is the 15th and 16th position cars looking to get back onto the lead lap, but trying to stop them from doing that. The second, third and fourth place cars behind them.
The battle that's interesting is the second and third though as well. Look at the Nissan coming down through the elbow. Falkenthayer's elbow has been cleaned up now, and it is the dark coloured Mercedes-Benz. Oh, and here comes Wolfie Reeve. Dodges to the right-hand side of the Porsche. He'll pick up a little bit of a tour from the Audi. He's going to have to thread the needle and go back to the left. This is where the gamer in him comes to life. He saw the opportunity there and seized on it. He was like a snake going after a rat there as he went straight through. Bit them both and made the pass on two.
We've talked about the computer gamer turned racer that these Nissan GT Academy program develops. You could not push the X button down any harder. Right there down Conrod Straight. Amazing stuff, Wolfie Reeve, threading the eye of the needle through the lapped cars who are in the same class, so they're every bit as quick.
That was brilliant, wasn't it? Because he used the draft of the cars ahead of him absolutely perfectly. How Nissan keep turning out of the GT Academy guys that don't have the experience in racing, and yet they sit there and you'd think they've gone through karting and formula races. It's almost like they put the USB stick in and just imported it all from Bob and Liz Neville.
It's fabulous stuff. And the other car that's now coming into the mix is this one. It's the number 10 Bentley from Guy Smith. He's making his way quickly through fourth position now and closing in on the Erebus Mercedes, but with another Audi to deal with, which is it's a lapped car. Well, Marcus Vingegaard, meanwhile, has got away 7 seconds to the good. Well, I think we're going to see a very quick lap now from Wolfie Reed.
Three times today, Marcus Vingegaard's been gifted a safety car restart that goes to absolute perfection for the number 15 Audi, because there's always been between four to six cars between he and this GTR behind. So all Marcus has to do is look forward and focus on what's in front rather than defending from the cars behind. It's working perfectly to plan for Phoenix Racing Audi today.
Guy Smith getting dialed into the mountain very, very quickly indeed. Had a good chat with him early on in the week down in town. The team were out having a team curry. Bond doing a bit of bonding there. This is a team run, of course, with Malcolm Wilson's M Sport backing from Bentley as well. Effectively, the works blessed team. And Malcolm Wilson known, and M Sport known very well down here, of course, from World Rally Championship. And they are making a big investment in their racing side of things, with a private circuit being built up in the northwest of the UK, and the Bentley dwarfing the Audi as it goes through on the entrance of the Michelin Chase. Not a pass for position there, but important yards made up on the guys ahead of him.
Down the Comrade Straight, that thing sounds like a low-flying Spitfire. Absolutely amazing stuff. We're hearing from some of the fans when they had three of them in close formation yesterday about the amazing sight and the sound, Grailsy.
Black flag, we're being told, car 11. The second Bentley scored in eighth. Harold Premat behind the wheel. We're getting the message it may well be for a restart infringement. Second time today we've seen that. Car 11 inside the top 10 in eighth at the moment, with Harold Premat behind the wheel. We're getting told they will receive the black flag and go to pit lane. Mark Beretta with more from a very busy Mount Panorama pit lane.
Yeah, it's great. There's a lot happening at the moment. Richard Muscat doing a great job in the Erebus Mercedes-Benz SLS. His teammate Dean Canto's with me. Dean, Richard's really kicked this day off well for you guys.
Yeah, look, qualifying didn't go our way, but we knew we had a strong race car. Look, there's still 10 hours to go, but we're happy with the way things are going. The brakes are holding out, the tyres are lasting, and I was getting in at the end of the first in there, but Richard wanted to stay in, so he's hogging the car, but I'll get in soon.
So the car's obviously in good shape. How good a result do you guys think you can get? Are you thinking podium?
My expectation is a podium. Obviously, there's still some tough competition right at the front, but I have full faith in our boys, the team, the drivers, that we should be on the podium there.
Which is good news, because as Betty was telling us earlier, you've got some young guys with you this year too.
Yeah, I do feel old with these young guys. We got Austin, who's 16, and Jack and Richard, I'm driving with at 22. So I'm feeling quite the senior, but they're very switched on young guys, very smart about driving the race car. So I'll just help them along any way I can.
And Dino, you've been in a lot of race teams over the year, but I've got to say the vibe in Erebus here at the moment with the young guys racing, it's just a really good vibe about it.
Yeah, look, and I'm here too, so.
And you, of course.
No, look, the young guys are doing a great job. They're a good bunch of kids and not smart asses, but, full credit to the team. They've done a great job putting the lineup together.
How good is that SLS going?
Yeah, pretty well. I never leave the car without a smile on my face, so I'm waiting to get in. About another 20 laps and I'll be in the car.
All right, good luck out there. Thanks, Dan.
Yeah, well, cheers.
He was our chauffeur around the mountain yesterday, Dean. Good chap. Good crack with him around the mountain. There's a black flag out over the start finish line again, guys.
It's the number 8 car. The number 11 Bentley has just had a run down pit lane for a restart infringement. This time it's Brabs. David Brabham is getting the black flag, and passes underneath us right now. You'd have to say that's likely to be the same thing.
They are very, very hot, and rightly so, on overlapping. You don't even have to pass. You cannot pull out and get alongside another competitor before the start finish line. You must stay in line.
Point being made by one viewer and listener on Twitter, Hendrik, good morning, that whilst, yes, it's absolutely correct that Marcus Vingegaard has been making good his escape with each of those restarts, he's been losing time because, of course, the fields have been big compressing under the safety car. Well, he's been making good his escape in green flag running. Meantime, though, for second position, we've got almost nose to tail now. The Erebus Mercedes back with Wolfie Reed.
This has been a good stint for Richard Musket, and he's now locked to the rear bumper bar of the big Nissan GTR. These two cars, very similar philosophies in going GT racing. Front engine, rear drive. Their original donor road car was quite large, quite heavy, especially when you compare it to the lighter, more nimble Ferraris and Audis and Lamborghinis we see in this field. So the philosophy is similar. They make their speed in very similar ways, these two cars, notably up and down the hill. This is good news. It looks like the number six safety stop car is back in the lane and awaiting a fuel and a new driver perhaps, and we will send that car back onto the racetrack. Richard Gartner will get out of that car and one of the other three drivers will get back in. This was the car that found the wall at the top of Mount Panorama earlier on today.
Yeah, and just to point out, if you can get the car back out and it's safe, it will be allowed back out on the circuit. It's now 9 3/4 hours to go.
It never rains, but it pours. A second black flag will be shown to car 11 for another restart infringement. So what I'm thinking is that at the end of the second safety car, Harold Primack got booked for that. They didn't have time to give him the drive-through because the safety car came out straight away.
Yep.
And then on the subsequent restart, he's done the same thing and will get another drive-through penalty. This will cost the number 11 car in excess of a minute and a half, if not more, in total time lost, not to mention the time they were already behind the leaders. The crucial thing is, could drop them off the lead lap.
That's the killer. That is the absolute nightmare for them. And all that time made up on the circuit disappears in the blink of an eye when you're tootling down the pit lane on the pit lane speed limiter. So frustrating when that happens. So just under 9 3/4 hours to go, and the battles continue with Marcus Winkelhock for Phoenix leading. 2:03.3, by the way, has broken the race lap record set last year by Shane van Gisbergen. Wolfie Reap in second place, trying to close down, and then the battle's further down the field. The Lamborghini took a little bit of a different strategy early on.
They've been flying completely under the radar so far this weekend, and they've not
sometimes
shown...
It's not the worst thing.
No, it's not. They've not shown huge pace, though, and that's, for me, the concerning thing, because it's all well and good getting to a good point in the race as the 11 car does serve its second drive-through penalty in two laps, and Harold Primack will be very, very frustrated with that. But Craig Baird and Stephen Richards behind the wheel of the Interloy Lambo haven't shown the raw speed they'd need to battle for victory here at Mount Panorama. The race is warming up. We're more than 2 hours in. It's a beautiful day on the mountain. The GT cars are out, and the Liqui Moly Bathurst 12-hour continues.
Take a ride up Mount Panorama on a Sunday. It's a nice scenic drive. It's a bit more hairy when your chauffeur-driven Bentley has Guy Smith at the wheel as he goes across the top, McPhillamy, and heads towards the Seven News skyline with the sun right in his eyes now. He's sitting in fourth position, and last time around did a 2:05 lap around Mount Panorama. And these Bentleys have taken to the mountain as if they were born here. Front-engined V8 4-litre, very clever engine from the road car, being tuned a wee bit to put into the GT3 version of the Bentley Continental Coupe, but retains the architecture, and this is a 200-mile-an-hour workshop for Bentley. It's a laboratory, and yet every car that they build reflects the same brand values as the cars that you would buy at your local Bentley dealer. Is this the same as yours, Rich?
It's almost identical to the one I'll be certainly not driving later. Guy Smith here, one of the guys with most Bentley heritage in motorsport, of course, has won the Le Mans 24 Hours in a very different Bentley, but he's won in this car already too. Was across in Utah in the last year in a sprint race to see him winning with the Dyson Racing team in a very similar car to this one. Just a fabulous piece of kit.
Notice he's not taking his hand off the steering wheel, of course, because it's paddle shift on the gearboxes for the GT3 cars. That is allowed nowadays. You've got traction control. You've also got ABS braking, and the drivers will change that sometimes from corner to corner here. Talking to Matt Griffin in the Clearwater Ferrari over the weekend, seeing that most of the time he turns it down to perhaps number two on the traction control, setting one on the Ferrari is completely off. But you will see Guy, amazingly, whilst he's passing, whilst he's concentrating, whilst he's hitting his clipping point there for the apex of the cutting and going up, just messing about with some of those dials. There's little buttons as well that you can use on the thumb to cycle through various things on the dashboard and make very fine tuning and just changing the slight settings of perhaps the gear shift or, as I say, the traction control of the ABS.
And for our viewers on 7 Sports 7 Rate this morning, don't forget we'll be switching to 7 not too far away from this point in the motor race. But for those that are used to seeing motor racing at Mount Panorama, these cars produce their speed in a very different way. These cars are about grip, they're about downforce, they're about traction. They're not so much about muscling them around, though Guy Smith was doing that just then with the tail just wagging around on the entry to the elbow. These cars are about keeping momentum up. They're not as fast in a straight line as what we've seen here at Mount Panorama in the past. I say that. 285 kilometres an hour is plenty fast enough. But watch this. We grab 6 gear before the hump, rev the engine out as far as they can go without lifting the aero, the big slits, flat, slick tyres through the chase, and then they brake at about 120 metres and stop the car down to third gear for the chase. So braking efficiency is amazing, aero efficiency doubly so. And these cars produce their speed very, very well around here.
Went round the circuit with Stephen Kane in a road-going version of this car. 110 metres is where they brake in that car. Absolutely staggering stuff.
Don't
these guys make it look easy? You're watching these in-car shots now. It almost makes you believe as if you can do this. Believe me, you cannot do this. These cars are otherworldly behind these cars, behind the wheels of these cars.
McLaren. Coming up through the field, hasn't been an easy start for those guys, and Shea Adam is down in their pit.
One word I just heard you using a lot there, Krelzy, was aero, and aero was very important, especially at Mount Panorama. That was something that the McLaren was having issues with in the form of their rear diffuser, and it started to come loose over the top of the mountain, getting very squirrely for Clark Quinn, who did a brilliant first in, took the car all the way up into seventh position. Unfortunately, they're now down about 7 or 8 laps. Clark said probably can't make that up over the span of the race. Not sure how much further they will go, but right now, Kevin Estra behind the wheel of the car. We can count on him to put in some fast laps while the car is fixed and ready to go.
Yeah, Kevin Estra did something that I never thought I'd see in my lifetime. He lapped in a GT3, a production-based car, around the Nürburgring Nordschleife in the fast lap qualifying last year, as quick as Group C cars had done in the day. 8:09, I think it was, for the Nordschleife and the Grand Prix circuit. We reckon he spent just around about 6:20, 6:30 on the Nordschleife. And when you look back through the history books, there are faster times than that, but there was one. And it was done by a very special driver. The rest of the field were still doing those 6:30s.
What we're watching here is a very fast McLaren trying to work its way past two guys fighting for the final spot, at least at this stage, on the podium. That's the battle for third place with Richard Muscat in car 36, the black Mercedes-Benz SLS AMG. Behind them, the man we were looking at and following for a few laps before, Guy Smith. Third and fourth, the official margin 0.3 of a second. And they're dicing for the miners here with Winkelhock and Reap still leading this race.
And what that shows me, guys, is that we've been robbed of the McLaren being right up the sharp end of this field because of that diffuser problem at the back of the car. Because clearly, at least when that has been fixed, Kevin Estre has been able to find the speed in that car, find the balance. I wonder if they've maybe had that issue all weekend and not known that it was coming and going, because one of the things about downforce, if you've got something flapping around or just slightly moving, it makes the car feel very loose. You'll often go and try and chase a mechanical setup problem when in fact it's an aero one.
Well, and this is certainly not a slight against the team and the work they've done. They've had the engine out of that car this weekend. They've had the rear end of the car off, chasing the faults that they've been chasing all weekend, so that might have led to the problem. It may have been contact in the early stages. We probably won't know until at least the end of the race, but what we're seeing now is a driver that's grabbed that McLaren by the scruff of its neck and is driving it as hard as possible and trying to claw back every little bit of lost ground. We saw lap records broken in this race 4.5 hours into it last year. If that happens again today, I've got no doubt that it may well be that bright orange car that does the job.
The lap record went earlier, didn't it? 2:03.3 on lap 29 to Marcus Vinkelhock, who still leads, by the way, by an increasing margin, almost 16 seconds up the road from Wolfie Reap, flying the Nismo flag with a big burbling GTR. Then Richard Muscat, Guy Smith, Darrell O'Young now in the 97, and Stefan Ortelli off kilter with everyone else. Remember, in the 16, he is in sixth position.
Well, yeah, I'm on board with this and GTR with Wolfie Reap
coming down through the Michelin chase. Now watch, he'll straight line that corner because you've got a little brow in the middle of the road. Now get up through the gears, pick your braking point for Maguire Murray's the final corner. Bang, 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 down through the gearbox. Don't ride too much of the curb. In fact, he did that. He just had a short shift to stop the wheel spin at the back of the GTR. Set yourself up for hell corner, turn number one. Down two gears. Use the camber on the roads and now fire yourself up mountain straight. Just gradually drift yourself to the left. It's quite a big brow here, and on a street car, you do get a little bit squirrely over the top, a little bit light. Position yourself on the left-hand side of the road. You're going to go down three gears into Griffin Bend. Oh, he's a little bit wide there as he turns in. You have to use the curb on the exit. Don't hook his wheel over the top of it, though. It'll put you in all sorts of trouble. He's quite conservative on the inside. Takes a very inside line there through the first part of the cutting and now heading uphill. Short shift, short shift. You want to be in fourth gear and balance it on the throttle over the right-hander at the top.
Great part.
Just trying to steer off that curb there. He clipped it maybe a tiny bit too much.
There's the middle grade.
That's the turning point, and you turn in very aggressively at that point. You have to. You've got to believe that the track hasn't moved since the last time around. The sun's moved away now as we go across Seven U Skyline and drop down into the S's. Down one, two gears. He's got a BMW in front of him. Balance the car. Brake down for further gear. He's now looking for space around the BMW. He'll go around driver's left. Huge slide from the back of the Nissan. No tyre on earth can keep that car in a straight line when all of that power and torque through the Falcon tyre's elbow and out onto the strip, and that's when you get a breath.
Conrod Strait, let's have a listen to the Nissan GTR all the way down to the end of the chase.
In the air, 22.5 on the track. Our Michelin track temperature's coming through, so we're starting to get that heat back in the tarmac now.
Great lap, controlled lap. He's not got a huge amount of traffic around him at the moment, Wolfgang Reed. The other thing we now need to start taking into equation is driver times. There are regulations in the event regs that stipulate how long any one driver can spend in the car at any one time.
We are, but before we get into that, we've had a change of position, because I think, have we just seen, certainly we've got the McLaren now ahead of the 36 car, and the McLaren now rapidly closing in, not for position, of course, but will be a factor here, rapidly closing in on Wolfgang Reed.
You make a good point, though, Krilzy, because there have been a number of races recently that have been decided, podium positions have been decided after the event, when the log's been going through.
We heard from Jordan Taylor on Twitter before at the Rolex 24 at Daytona. They were a recipient of that. So 3 hours in any one stint at any one time is the maximum a driver can spend in the car. 4.5 hours out of the 12 is the total driving time. So right now, Marcus Winkelkopf has been in the car for 2.5 hours. He leads the race. Wolfgang Reep has been the same. They're first and second, thanks to Michelin on our hourly update leaderboard. Guy Smith, fourth. Darrell Young, fifth for Aston Martin. Ortelli, Rugolo for Ferrari, chipping away and going nicely. Then Jono Lester, David Brabham still inside the top 10, and Simon Hodges for Erebus completing the 10 in the number 63 car. And here, John Hindhoff are our class leaders.
Yeah, the Pirelli hourly class update. The Darrell Lee overall, it is Vinkelhock from Reap in the AM class of that. Remember, just one seeded driver in the car. They lead. Ben Barker is leading the GT3 Cup class with Century Batteries. The Ridges GT4 category, that's Aston Martin, and that's the 76 car. Rick Hislop is still at the head of the GWS personnel at Class D standings in that lovely Daytona Coupe. And Keith Kazulka in the Mazda 3 V8. Saw that car had a bit of problems earlier on. Well, they're back at the head of the Recaro Class I, the Invitational Endurance category. We've had 2.5 hours of this race. It's looking to be another classic, and we could break more records here at the 2015 Liqui Moly Bathurst 12 Hours. To some kind of racing rhythm now, thank goodness, because the early incidents have left, I think, us as spectators as well as the drivers and teams slightly frustrated that we haven't seen really how things are playing out. What we do know is that the 15 Phoenix car under Marcus Vinkelhock is indecently quick around here, and we've also found out that Wolfie Reap has made the transition from gamer to racer very well indeed. Those two head the field. There's 21 seconds between them, and then another 11 seconds further back to the stealthy but very quick 36 Mercedes-Benz Erebus car of Richard Muscat. Battles, of course, continue on. People are trying to stay on the lead lap, near the lead lap. At this place, it's kind of like jockeying position at the moment, the opening rounds of a heavyweight fight, Krilzy, and everyone's trying to use a phrase, they're trying to feel out what's going on the track and with their opposition. There's as much thinking going on the pit wall and in the pit boxes at the moment as there is skill going through the steering wheels.
Yeah, what we've had now too though is a good bit of rhythm coming into the motor race. As you mentioned, they're getting into a groove, they're getting some consistency, they're getting the ebb and flow of the motor race right. But as we mentioned before the last commercial break, that we're coming up to the maximum driver time that guys like Marcus Vinkelhock and Wolfgang Reap are going to be allowed to spend in the car. However, I don't think that matters. The last time we saw the 15 car in pit lane was lap 33. They will pit very soon. This is the Maguire's replay down the inside at the Falcon Tyres. Hello. I heard a vicious rumour that there was a big move down the inside by the Ferrari.
Very good. That was the golf clap in the background was me, because that was an outstanding opportunist overtaking manoeuvre by the vicious rumour.
Still Benny Simonson, I think.
And it is still Benny at the wheel of that car. And now he's monstering our camera car a lap or so later at the same point on the track, looking back from the JBS Australia 32 car.
It's Renato Liberto actually behind the wheel of that car, so they had a driver change at their last stop. He's the amateur driver in that car, unseated, but this is a guy with a huge amount of racing experience and amateur filmmaker too. Makes some very impressive videos for his Instagram and social media accounts, but
he'll be wanting that footage right now.
He's applying the thumbscrews to the back of Roger Largo. They're scoring 20th and 21st at the moment.
So this is a battle for position.
It is for position.
Down the inside into Maguire's at Murray's, and there he's got through. Marvellous stuff, and that is exactly what he was trying to do. He set it up earlier on as he came down through the chase, and that is a classic Bathurst pass at the final corner. Now traffic and Roger's vote. Now that, see, that to me is the sensible way. Roger there playing the long game. He's let the Ferrari go through, and then he doesn't try and take it all back underneath the Mazda RX-7, the ex-Grand Am car, at the next corner. That is the kind of thinking you've got to have when there's still 9.5 hours or thereabouts to go.
Now, the difference between the full-time professional racing car drivers and the weekend warriors, the guys that do it once or twice a year, or running GT racing or Porsche racing, more as a hobby rather than their full-time career. Last time around, Roger Largo doing 2-minute 11s in that car at the start of the race, Steve Owen was punching out low 205s, high 204s. So that's the difference. That's why that car's dropped out of the top 10 and is now down in 21st position.
That will be being conservative through traffic. Roger is a decent driver. He's
no doubt
losing that on these places, not where you need to have full metal you-know-whats to get over the top. He is losing that because he's not putting the car and himself in a situation that he doesn't think he can get himself out of. And that's the key. Patience, patience, patience. He will have been telling the drivers that. The team manager will have been telling the drivers that. And that's a perfect, perfect way to run this motor race. If you're at the head of the field and you're one of the hired hop shoes, then clearly you're going to try and make that time every lap. Sometimes, though, that just doesn't pay off. And for these guys, their best chance is to stay out of trouble and be there after the last pit stop.
Number 11, Bentley pits on lap 62. So we're now getting an idea of fuel economy in this race. That 32-lap stint for Harold Primack included two drive-through penalties. Yeah. He might be keen to get out of that car.
Let's have a listen to see Roger through the kick. See, he's flat.
He's flat.
He's flat.
Look, there's no doubting Roger's capability as a racing car driver, but it's just the difference of level of driver within the field. And up against Steve Owen and David Russell, Roger will be the first person to tell you that he will not be as fast as those two.
And remember, this car on a different strategy from many of the rest. The outer sequence with the bulk of the Class A grid. But in addition to that, what we've also seen is they've cycled in their gentleman driver early. So I think what they may well be trying to do there is to gamble with a busier track, with more cars out there at the moment, but potentially you might be getting more of those safety car periods earlier in the race.
Yeah, and that again, managing the talent that you have in front of you. You can only play with the cards that you're dealt, and people will use those talents, use those resources in different ways. You heard Pat Long earlier on talking to Peretz, wasn't it, in the pit lane, about what they were going to do. That might not be the same as everybody else. What you do want, though, Crilsey, is at the end of the race, last 4 hours or so, you want to make sure that the very fastest guys that you've got are ready to go and do what needs doing. Late safety car, we've seen it here before. Let's be honest, a 15-minute, 20-minute dash for the trophy, it could happen. You don't want to be running out of hours at the end of the race for your fast guy.
No, and you want to make sure you've got your fast guys for that crucial final 2 or 3 hours of the motor race. Tell you what, there's a bit going on in this top 10. Richard Muscat still under huge amounts of pressure from Guy Smith. They're still split by 0.4 seconds. Behind them, Darryl O'Young has just set his car's fastest lap of the motor race, which is always a good indication that they're about to stop. 2.05.0 for the number 97, Aston Martin. Stefan Otelli has done the same in the number 16, Phoenix Racing Audi, in sixth place, just behind. He's 2 seconds behind Darryl O'Young, the 2.05.3. So they're getting the hammer down and it's all closing up, but that battle for third is properly on. It's been on for the whole 30 laps of this stint. It's been going. Muscat under immense pressure from Guy Smith.
Down in the Nissan pit, it's time for a pit stop, and Florian Strauss was the next man to get in, the Nismo Athlete Global Team. So Katsumasa Chiyo being held back.
Now let's just remind everybody here, Florian Strauss has had, what, less than 4 years worth of professional racing experience. Actually, just over, isn't it? I think he debuted last year at the Dubai 24
Correct.
Hours.
And this year at the Dubai 24 Hours, he led the team and started that race with 89 cars starting under that green flag. All right, we're just going round to pit stops. Let's get ready for action. And our very own action man down in the pit lane is Mark Beretta.
With John Bauer, who's been sitting here patiently for a little while, waiting, JB, as you've done so many times, but the call's come up, 2 laps, you're in the car.
Yeah, David has done a fantastic job. The car is actually going along really well. I mean, as the other Bentleys are. So, you know, it's a really long day. We've done 3 hours, haven't we? So, you know, anything could happen. And we've already seen some of the drama that goes on. So, you know, what a great race. What a fabulous
race. I was just going to say, you've seen a lot of races, but there's something about this today, isn't there? This is going to be a special Bathurst 12-hour.
Yeah, I think it is. I think the Bathurst 12-hour is a special race, but I've done nearly 1,000 races, and this is one of the highlights, honestly.
That's a big wrap. JB, we'll let you get ready. All the best out there, mate. Have a great run.
I've got to say how wonderful you look in that suit.
Thank you. You're not the first. Thanks, JB.
No, we thought so too. If Barrett's pulls the white off, we like it. We like it. As the Nissan Global Athlete Team goes to work on the number 35 car. So they've gone 33 laps on a stint, a couple of safety cars included in that. But we're finally getting an idea now of relative fuel economy in these cars. And Wolfgang Riep was behind the wheel, but there has been a driver change. And it looks like Florian Strauss now getting behind the wheel. Was drafted into this squad in the lead up to the motor race. We heard about Alex Buncombe before. Congratulations to Alex and his family.
the birth of baby Austin. Alex was slated to drive this car two times. He's been to Bathurst in February last year at this race, and in October he did a ripper job for the Works Nissan team. Unfortunately had to pull out with the impending birth of baby number one. Turned out wasn't as fast as his father. Took some delays getting in there. A bit of a drive-through penalty, perhaps.
2 weeks before
he get exactly right. But Florian Strauss has been very impressive on his first visit to Mount Panorama. So the Nissan done and dusted leaves pit lane and heads up mountain straight as the race leader crosses the start-finish line. So that gives you an idea of the gap when you pit and how much time you lose. Marcus Winkelhock leads the race. Erebus Motorsport now up to second place and 34 seconds behind our race leader with Richard Musket. Guy Smith in the Bentley for the first time today appearing inside the top three. Darryl O'Young fourth, Otelli fifth, but stops to come.
And a new set of Michelin tyres going in with a new driver. That takes a little bit more time, gives them time to do the driver change. So Florian Strauss just taking it steady and bringing in the tyres in. No tyre blankets, of course, allowed.
No, absolutely right. So you need to build up. The last thing you need to do is go out on cold Pirellis or cold Michelins and put the thing in the wall at the top of the mountain. That would be absolutely terrible for everybody involved. 1%ers make races like this, the tiny little differences that can make or break your race victory. Class B Porsche car number 21 were given a stop and hold penalty for 10 seconds for personnel not wearing correct headgear while the car was being refueled. You must wear a helmet if you are on the refueling team. It's tiny little things like that that the team managers must have sorted in this race to make sure you minimise the chance of getting penalised. Brabham in pit lane for that anticipated stop. We heard from John Bowe, keen to get in the Flying V Racing Bentley. David Brabham's done a super job in the opening stint, got that car right up inside the top 10.
V6 then being put to the sword by Florian Strauss as he completes his first lap of the racing conditions here at Mount Panorama, getting the thing slowed down for Maguire's under the Liqui Moly Bridge, and he goes past us and heads up towards Hell Corner. Let's see where he breaks. He's pretty much on the 100 metre board there, turning in, settling himself down. Talk to Bob Neville, the man who runs the GT Academy, and as far as the racing side of things, along with Lizzie's wife, the RGN team, massively involved in that. Let's have a look at the Maguire's replay here. This is, oh, that's a very nasty hit, and that's the 11 Bentley going around, and that is avoidable contact of the very greatest nature by the Audi.
It's not that Audi on pit lane straight away. That's the number 9 car.
And that was being driven.
Marcini, I think, was behind of that car.
Bentley's in and out.
That's the brake car, I think. Make it
flying
way away.
B. So JB at the wheel of the Flying B.
Marcini, the most experienced Porsche Carrera Cup racer in Australia, and doing a solid job in that car with Christopher Meese and Mark Eddy still to come. The pit stop shuffle is happening. The Bentleys are in pit lane. There's plenty going on the mountain. More of it still to come. Oh.